Hello and welcome everyone to podcast number 15. I am your host, Terry Miller, the Disc Golf Guy, and sitting next to me here in our studio is Jonny V. Jonny, 15 weeks in, why are we having technical difficulties to open the show?
You know, it just kind of went with the week. We had our primary guest, who we were originally going to have on.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He was having some traveling issues.
Sure, sure.
And then our normal stats guy, he's having some internet issues. Looked like he had some Comcast issues, if you saw from Facebook, all the wires coming out of his basement. I don't think that's what you're supposed to. If he had Mike Schwieger do it, that never would have happened.
I know, one of our good buddies.
Cable installation. And then, so then we boot up the computer here, and it's not spitting out video at first. So, a couple minutes, you know, like 2 minutes late.
2 minutes. I think you get par plus four. So, as usual, you're starting over par. Well, and that's not good.
It's rarely good.
All right. Well, also here in the Smashbox studios, we're performing in front of a live studio audience tonight. We've got good friends and guests. Colin Huff and Dustin Skorpinski, a couple of local Milwaukee area disc golf studs. And if you want to challenge anyone in that intermediate division, you got to go through these two first.
You know,
they're bringing the noise.
They're a fearsome twosome.
Yes, they are. And before we even get into AJ and the stats from the weekend, we got to send a big, huge shout out to our boy Ryan Heedy, who we're going to be joining in just a few days. He was down in Vegas, and I was told he won by a significant margin of 10 strokes.
Wow.
In the recreational division. We won by 10 strokes down there.
If you're winning by 10 in the recreational division, is it time to bump up?
Absolutely.
Okay.
That's not quite the pro tip of the week, but that is that's at least the intermediate tip of the week. So, as usual, we've got a show lined up for you tonight. We've got a ton of exciting news. We hear some people saying that they like our show regardless. Well, tonight, I think we've got a few added bonuses in there. And like you said, we've got AJ Risley filling in for Dynamite. And we also have Simon Lizotte, our world record distance holder for the furthest disc ever thrown of all time. He's going to be joining us on the show tonight. Kale Leviska originally was our planned guest. However, he was traveling through Colorado and wasn't going to make it to his destination or something like that. And so he gave us the heads up this morning. And I reached out to Simon, and we've got some news that impacts both Simon and Kale anyway. So it works out perfect.
Yeah, that'll be perfect for us.
Seeing on the board, hopefully everybody out there is Box Smashers Unite. Thanks, Ben Ferris. We know you were out there. DG Mike. Wow, you'd think I could spit that out.
I don't.
But please go out and share and let everyone know that we are live and we are getting to the action. We're going to go through kind of a unique format tonight. Like I said, we're going to have an extra guest or two from what we normally have. Yep. So we're going to kind of be bouncing all around. And we've got some big, exciting news just on multiple fronts.
And one of these guys going to be our extra guest?
I don't know. We might be able to
some after show guests.
We might be able to work something out. We'll see how things go. So, without further ado, let's move into. Do we still play the intro? I mean, he did make it.
Oh, we can play it. Yeah, let's play it.
Let's play the intro.
Boom goes the Dynamite.
And I think he's okay. And joining us on the show tonight is AJ Risley, affectionately named or nicknamed the Disc Golf Boy. AJ, I don't know if I'm quite old enough to be your daddy, but welcome to the show, buddy. Thanks for coming on tonight.
Well, thanks for having me. Well, I guess I should thank Dana for having me or for giving up his spot. But glad to be here, regardless.
Yeah, Dana says if you do too good that we're going to have to replace him. And then I said, are you telling me? Are you quitting? Is that what you want? He's like, no. But, you know, if
is it even possible for,
I don't know,
for you guys to get rid of him?
I'm sure we could find a way.
You're right.
I'm sure we could say something. He wouldn't want to join us.
So you have some big shoes to fill, as you said. I think you said you're size 13.
Size 13s.
What kind of action did you find going on in the disc golf world this weekend, and what can you give us some updates on, buddy?
Well, I mean, second week of February, there's still a lot of stuff going on to get the season started. I mean, as you know, we've got the first national tour event coming up in a couple weeks, preceded by one of the biggest A tiers of the year. So the week before that, people are still kind of warming up out here in Southern California. We've got the Wintertime Open, which is, I believe it was the 37th annual Wintertime Open in Pasadena, California this year. I guess I'll start with that. We had a pretty stacked field. There were about, let me check my notes. There were 42 players in the open field this weekend. A lot of players showing up, a lot of really good players too.
Now there were 42 players in the open field. How many of them finished?
Let's see. I think there were 39 or 40 players that finished the tournament. In the open field.
And one of them wasn't...
Wasn't you?
Yes.
Okay.
You did look a little swollen. I'll say that.
Thanks.
Around the cheeks.
If anybody didn't know, if no one's on my, stalking my Facebook or being my friend, I guess that's usually what people call it. Yeah, right before the second round was about to start, while we were warming up, I was teeing off, practicing some drives, and I came off the tee pad and rolled my ankle pretty bad. It did not feel great. It swelled up pretty instantly, and I kind of took a minute to do some breathing exercises, I guess you could call it that. And I walked up. I got up, walked it off a little bit, and played the whole second round that day with who knows what kind of ankle. But then I didn't play the round on Sunday, so I didn't finish the tournament. But that's just cautionary to hopefully play well this weekend and next week.
Sometimes you got to stand down or fall down to get ready for the next week, and
fall
that makes
down
sense.
Stand up.
Oh, I definitely, I definitely fell down. Yes.
Okay, so give us some stats. What happened over there?
Okay, so one of the players in the field was the three-time current world champ, Paul McBeth. Mm-hmm. And he usually has a pretty good showing out there in Oak Grove. He ended up winning, surprise, surprise, by 9 strokes this time. I think last year it might have been 10. So who knows?
He's falling, maybe in a he's few years. Falling behind. You know, you've got 9 more years before someone can beat him.
You really got to think, is it a surprise that he wins, or really the surprise every weekend should be is how many he won by? Like Paul won.
Did somebody come close?
Oh, no, he won by 9. and I really had him picked to win by 14. Oh, he's pretty dominant in that sense.
Yeah. No, yeah. So he won by 9 strokes over Steve Rico and Philo Brathwaite. No slouches there. Mm-hmm. But, man, he was... he was putting on a pretty good show. There are some holes out there at Oak Grove in that wintertime layout that are par fours that you don't really think to eagle. And he eagled one of them one time during warm-ups, and then one time I believe it was the start of the second round. He made like a 100-foot putt that, you know, apparently wasn't, you know, didn't take too much effort.
Was that what we saw online? He was talking about the Sports Center top 10, where he threw up the big spike hyzer and then dropped in, you know, the easy 100-footer.
Yeah, right. He throws a big, there's a big stall shot hyzer over the trees, under the gap. There's like this 5-foot gap off the tee that people are trying not to, like, you know, they slow down their follow through so they don't break their hand. But he doesn't really care, and he just kind of goes over everything around a mandatory pole and makes a 100-footer.
Yeah. Hashtag NBD.
Yeah, no big deal. There was also a 6-way tie for 9th place in open. That was pretty pretty cool. A lot of people felt like shooting the same score. In the women's division, open women's, we had a Team Legacy member, Owen Scoggins, taking down the win by 13 strokes. So great job, Owen. Hashtag owning. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. And then also other news for this event, we had my friend Super, or Super Dave, Dave Brittato, a.k.a. Keahikai. You can find him on Facebook under Keahikai. But he prefers to be called Super, and I respect that. He had the hot round of the tournament the first day with a 52, 9 under par, pretty good, in the Masters division.
Mm, okay.
So he was killing it, and no one else shot that good of a round until Sunday when Paul shot another 52.
Oh.
So
he'll do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, whatever. And then let's see. Let's move on to Las Vegas for the Gentlemen's Club Challenge, the AM weekend. I know. Sorry, I can see that. I can see that face you're making. Sorry. I gotta give a shout out to those MA1s, MA2s, MA3s, FA1s, FA2s. Anyways, so in the advanced division, taking down the win is Jason Jet Tydinko from San Diego, California. What do you know? He won by 2 strokes over, I don't know if they're brothers, but the two guys with the last name Russell. They might be related somehow, but
there's a good chance of that, I bet. The past couple weeks we've been talking about brother combinations. And
how distant are their PDGA numbers? That might be telling.
Yeah, they're pretty far apart. I think one is in the 30,000s, one's in the 60,000s.
How about home cities or states?
This is why
we need Dana. All right. This is
I'll give everyone can he's got a messed up ankle. He can stumble. He was so good last time.
He was. Let's see if he picks it back up. All right, moving on.
Yeah. Okay, well, actually, hey, speaking of brothers, mm-hmm. Jason Tydinko won the advanced division and his brother Ben Tydinko won the intermediate division.
Okay.
So boom.
That's
back on top. Anyways, all right, let's move on. Sorry.
Tydonculus.
No.
All right.
AJ, there might be a spot for you here next week if he keeps this up.
Yeah, how many? Yeah. I'll be out in Arizona.
That's right.
Okay, so let's keep moving east. We'll go to Texas. There were 2 1-day tournaments out there in Texas, not uncommon for sanctioned events in Texas. On Saturday, there was the Cedar Hill Chill. There were 41 players in open, and your champ was Cody Custard, and he beat out Jonny McRae by 1 stroke.
After McRae threw in from 115 feet on that birdie attempt we saw online?
I guess so. He probably should have thrown in another one from 115 feet if he wanted to
tie. Get
sudden death playoff.
Okay. Jonny McRae's not one to lose often. I mean, he's obviously as good as they get. So for anyone to take down Jonny McRae is there's something to be said about that.
That's a great weekend, no matter who you are.
Mm-hmm.
In the women's division, I think there were four women competing, and Smashbox listener Liz Dorries took down the win. It looked like she had a sudden death playoff with Maria Oliva.
Mm-hmm.
So congrats, Liz. On Sunday, there was the Town Lake Pro-Am. I believe that was sponsored by Dynamic Discs. 37 players in the open division. Another really strong turnout for a one-day tournament. Your champion on Sunday was, it starts with, first name starts with a J, last name starts with an M. Any guesses?
Jonny McRae. Would I win?
Oh, nothing. Sorry. Oh. The answer we were looking for was Jamie Mosier.
Mm-hmm.
So congrats to Jamie Mosier. He took it down. It looked like he also won a playoff. And he beat Jonny McRae by 1 stroke.
Ouch.
So, yeah, I think I'm going to go big hug for Jonny McRae. I think I'm going to do a little double tap, big hug.
I hope
2 tournaments, 2 losses, only lost by 2 strokes.
I want a video of the big hug next week.
I'm going to tell you right now, there's going to be a lot of big hugs given about by this guy next week in Arizona.
Ooh, big guy.
Whether they like him or not.
Well, most people don't.
They're getting them. All right. Well, that
be a vlog dedicated just to big hugs? Hug life?
Yeah, hashtag hug life? There could be.
Yeah, we'll make it happen.
I don't know if that'll be appropriate, but we'll find a way.
Yeah, we'll make it work. So, and then also in down there in Town Lake, at the Town Lake Pro-Am, Liz Dorries wins again, this time a little bit more comfortably by 6 strokes. So double congrats to Liz.
Everyone congratulate Liz as she's sitting in our board, talking and chatting with everybody.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Nice job, Liz.
Okay, and then let's see. Let's go even more east. We'll go to the Fox Chase Ice Bowl in North Carolina. Not as big of a turnout as these other events, but Michael Johansson is getting an early win to start off his season. So congrats to Michael Joe. And then let's see. Let's take it back to the West Coast. On Sunday, there was the Paradise season opener out here in Paradise, California, which compared to what's going on outside for you guys, I think that's a pretty,
mm-hmm, pretty accurate appropriate statement. Name. Yep.
Yeah. A lot of people showed up for that one up there in Northern California. Nico LaCastro took down the win by 7 strokes over Don Smith. So good job to Nico. It looked like those guys were having their fun throwing their flag outlaws or flag laws, as they're referred to. And let's see, Sarah Hokum and Jessica Weiss tied in the women's open division. Lots of heated battles going on between them already to start out this season. I don't know who won the playoff. I think I heard it was Jessica. So.
Yeah, I'm pretty certain it was Jessica as well that had won that playoff. I know Sarah said she'd be logged in tonight, but I'm pretty sure if I recall, I saw another post that said Jessica had won again. Something Dana would have had for us, but
hey, I didn't want to take too much of a risk, you know.
Yeah, no, that's all right.
All right. And then also in the advanced division out there, I got to give a shout out to my fellow Team Legacy member Charles Hoff III, mm-hmm, for taking down the advanced division. It's a good job, Charles. And then last but not least, in Houston, Texas, we had the TC Jester Open with a whopping field of 4 players.
four
players in men's pro open MPO. I think he's a Smashbox listener. Scooter took down the win by 6 strokes. Matt Hall, Scooter, you ever heard of him?
We've heard of him.
We know Matt.
Oh,
Hall.
We've heard. Oh, sorry. What year is it again? The 2015.
Sorry. Wow.
All right.
Yes. Making Anyways. Friends.
Not anymore.
No, we're not messing around anymore.
Yeah.
You know,
that's about for tournaments that happened this weekend.
Really? Because I know of one more tournament.
Yeah, I can give you a quick update, unfortunately.
Yeah, this weekend in our favorite city in Michigan, Climax, Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
One Larry LeBond ran the Cracked Plastic Classic, which we've all gone to here in Wisconsin quite a few times. I was not, mm-hmm, able to make it this time because of a little work obligation. But Terry was fortunate.
Yeah, we'll say fortunate. I'll go out and say fortunate.
Did he say how many years he's been running this? Is that like 18?
Well, I've been there, I think, 15 or 16 myself.
Yeah.
So, and I think I've only missed one in the last 16 or 17 years.
Yeah.
So it's been at least that many. Yeah. I don't know how many more before that.
I thought I saw 18, but I could be wrong there. So.
If it's 18, I've probably been. I think I've been there every year except for one since like 98 or 99.
Yeah.
I've been there for quite a few years. Last year I had a wedding obligation with a good friend. So
fill me in. Where is Climax?
Here's Michigan, cuz you know Wisconsin is kind of like that, but whatever. It is.
I tried to do that.
It's like kind of right here. Kind of right here.
Kind of right.
Yeah. Kind of.
Yeah.
It's closer to Lake Michigan side of Michigan. Nice. And it's technically, a lot of people know it as Kalamazoo. It's the Kalamazoo area.
Yeah, it's just outside.
It's a really tight, shorter. Well, it used to be shorter, and then there's some longer holes now. Wooded course. It requires a lot of technical skills. It was played in Worlds back in 2004.
2008.
2008. Sorry.
Perfect.
Gosh. Perfect for
T-Dogs.
Normally, style. It is perfect for T-Dog. T-Dog's taken that event down twice.
Something like that. Two or three times.
Two or three times. He's won. And I'll ruin the surprise. You didn't win this week.
I absolutely didn't win. Who did win was Mother Nature. Absolutely blistery, cold, way below zero, nasty, nasty winds and weather on Saturday, in which I traveled through part of that. And then on Sunday, I looked, and when I woke up, it was 6 below regular, and nice. Then you added wind chill, and it was negative 23 below.
So this is probably the second worst conditions we've
ever played.
And
sadly enough, yes, only the second worst conditions I've ever played there.
Yeah.
In 2008, I think I won that one, and we were talking. It was
40 mile an hour winds.
Yeah.
And it was, yeah, that was
below zero.
That was
it
brutal.
That's where a good portion of the fields, some of the fields had
just
quit.
They just don't show up second round, or, you know.
Yeah.
Usually my rule of thumb is for every degree Fahrenheit below zero, I drink another cup of hot cocoa per hour. So in that case, I would be drinking about 24, 25.
You'd be holding the course up with bathroom breaks.
Yeah.
But, who won that event, though?
You know, it was George Beno or Benno. It was different in that I didn't recognize as many players as I normally do there. There weren't some of the regulars. You normally would see an Al Sugar Shack at that event.
Mike.
Sometimes a Mike Raley.
Yep.
Kurt Hagedorn, Luna, is normally there. He had won it a couple years ago. He's old enough to play Masters or maybe even GM. And he's won it in the past.
Jamie Mosier's down.
Jamie, I don't normally see at that event, but yeah, Jamie's been there in the past.
I don't see. Did Larry not play this?
No, Larry LeBond didn't play this year. He sometimes competes.
He's the TD, and he sometimes competes.
Dave Felberg, I'm not going to say I've beat him there, but I have multiple times. That was one of his home courses. So obviously, Felberg's, I think, in another country right now, but whatever.
I'm getting cold just talking about this.
Yeah,
tournament.
So it was nasty.
We talk about warmer tournaments.
Yeah,
like
we will soon. Warm. We will soon. We'll talk about that.
We will. And I'll just say I did, in fact, as some of you saw on Facebook, Instagram, cracked a disc, my putter, the very first throw right out of the car. Hit lots of chain and metal. I mean, both pieces fell into the basket, of course. No, I'm just kidding, they didn't. But hit the nub on top of the number, near the number plate, and just cracked, very first throw of the day. So there was that. That was not awesome. But this will lead us to my pick of the week a little later. So that's a little teaser for that.
Ooh.
Pick of the week.
Thanks.
All right. Give us a real quick. We're going to see you at the memorial. I'm going to see you at the memorial. All of our beautiful fans are going to see you at the memorial. Give us a real quick rundown of what we're going to see at the memorial before we move on.
Well, for me personally?
Yep, give us a real quick.
Okay, well, I'm playing in the Gentlemen's Club Challenge the weekend before. I'm going to be getting into Phoenix, hopefully that Sunday night. And then Monday and Tuesday are going to be a lot of practice because, 2 days to practice for, you know, one of the biggest tournaments of the year. You got to make sure you use those 48 hours wisely and efficiently.
You played last year, correct?
Yeah, this will be my fourth year playing the Memorial. My third year as a pro. Gotta try to get in as much practice. I've been doing my research or my studying this past week or two. I go back and I watch videos from last year's tournament, so that kind of helps to get a little refresher as to, you know, what holes are out there. What my
I recommend
game plan
watching
is.
Macbeth's 40,
two,
42, 44,
no, 39.
Yeah, that's how you do it. I'm just saying. Like,
if you could get half of those birdies, practice, you'd be good.
Just watch that. If you can do that, you'll be okay. You play that course twice, I believe.
Yep.
I guarantee if you shoot that twice, you'll cash.
Well, here's what we're going to...
No, I guarantee that.
Here's what we're going to end, wrap things up on. I think we have to have a polite gentleman's club or gentleman's bet with our two guests that come on, AJ and Dana. I think there should be some kind of polite wager between the two of them. Maybe that's to earn your spot back on the show.
Next week.
Who can grow the reddest beard?
No.
No, we're talking play here.
Yeah.
Oh. Ooh.
We'll see. Yeah.
Play at the memorial.
We'll have a podcast. Maybe we could have them both on next Tuesday, because they'll both be in Arizona.
I'd be fine with that.
So. Let him arm wrestle.
We'll see if the fans will be fine with that, all right?
Yeah.
So don't get ahead of yourself, buddy.
Fans.
Well, AJ, thanks for joining us today. Thanks for filling in for Dana. We always appreciate it. I saw Dana on the board, so somewhere he's got some internet connection. It did pop up in the lower right-hand corner. Dana is now online. He might be on his phone for all we know. Mm-hmm. But we look forward to catching up with you next week at the memorial. I think as long as your ankle heals up, I think you'll be fine.
I think that's Ashley, by the way. Ashley's probably watching us, but anyway. No. Well, we'll see you next week.
Yeah. I'm. If anybody's worried, my ankle feels all right.
Good.
I've got ice. I've got Tiger Balm.
Wrap it.
Ace bandage.
Yep.
Wrapping it up. Yes.
Yeah. So kind of like your segment. Let's wrap it up.
Much like your ankle. Let's treat the segment and wrap it up.
All right.
But real quick, for all the Smashbox fans. Steve Rico and I will be getting matching haircuts, and look for that next week. We're going to be doing that live on SmashBoxxTV. So, matching haircuts.
Okay.
AJ Risley, Steve Rico.
Can Terry do the haircut?
Say what?
Can Terry give you the haircut on Tuesday night?
How's he going to? No, he's going to have to do the live commentary.
He can do both.
Is he going to give the haircut and commentate that whole thing?
How hard is it to work a razor?
Yeah.
You know what I see in your future? One of these logos right on the side. So, there all right. Thanks a lot, AJ. Have a good night.
All right. Thanks for joining us, buddy.
He
works really hard at not being asked back, but one we'll see how things fare when he takes on Dana, a little Dynamite action. AJ and Dana, I know Dana's got him by at least 15 to 20 ratings points, and anything can happen out there. But
about a stroke and a half around, maybe.
Yeah, at least
depending on the course.
It should be interesting to see how those guys fare again, one against another out there. And in just a moment here, it looks like we have joining us on the show is your world distance champion and record holder in
who's that?
Simon Lizotte.
Really?
That's who I heard. Welcome to the show, Simon. How you doing tonight, buddy?
Thank you, guys. Doing good. How are you?
Doing really well. So you are in California, and some people are kind of wondering, how does that fit into your tour life and what your traveling situation is like and how are you kicking off this year?
Well, the year kicked off with the Aussie Open in Australia, which I think there's been a lot of discussions about that. And for me, it was just amazing to be all the way down there on the other side of the world playing in 100 degrees. And yeah, after that, I flew to New Zealand for 10 days, which was also mind-blowing. Great tournament there also. And yeah, Friday, I flew into LA and I missed the Wintertime Open because it was just too much for me. And I'm also not going to play the Gentlemen's Club because I'm going to fly to Phoenix on Saturday to have more time to practice. But other than that, I love being in Cali. It's beautiful here. In Rancho Cucamonga, we have blue skies and 80 degrees every day. And yeah, right next to the factory. So I have all the discs in the world to choose from.
I was going to say, have you been able to go through and kind of maybe hand pick some discs, maybe look for a couple good distance drivers for the future? Or
Yeah, that's pretty much all I do.
I hope not. I hope you get out and enjoy California a little bit.
So you're not far from where AJ was at. Obviously, just talking to him out of the San Diego, you know, vicinity. You're in Rancho Cucamonga. There's been discussion about Discmania actually having a headquarters here in the U.S. We see that UC has been over in the U.S. quite a bit, more than in years past. Talk about what that means and how I know you're close to the Innova factory, but there's actually a separate Discmania office building. Is that correct? And do you work out of there?
Well, Innova is actually in Ontario, I believe, like the warehouse. And Discmania right now is sharing the same building as Hero Disc, which is in Rancho Cucamonga, about 10 minutes away from Ontario. And yeah, it's all, we established that last year, and it's growing and growing. And yeah, we're really pleased how it's going. And I'm just excited to have Discmania USA going right now for me. And yeah, in Europe, it's of course way, way better known than it is in the States, but it's growing and we're happy. And yeah, only bigger and better things to come.
So you broke the world record. You were challenging good friend and previous record holder, David Wiggins, and then you broke the world record with a Blizzard-weighted boss. Is there just, I mean, clearly that's your disc of choice. Is there, what's it about that disc? What is it about the Blizzard, you know, plastic? What is it that makes that, you know, a winning combination for you?
Well, if you're going like for your max D that's possible for you, it's really crucial to get the right disc for your arm speed and your spin. And the boss is just, for me, it has such a straight finish. Like, I've been throwing the DD2 also. It's kind of similar in the beginning, but it just hooks back quicker in the end. And for distance shots in the desert and with those winds, you really want the disc to flip and then go straight and not like this golf S curve. You're just looking to flip and then ride straight for as long as possible. And the boss is just, yeah, doing that really well for me. And Avery actually gave me his distance discs. He had like 8 really nice first run Blizzard bosses where the bubbles were actually still in the flight plate, which gives a little more this aerobic effect where the rim is actually heavier. So, oh, I actually got it right here. This is the one.
Oh, it's handy.
That's the actual disc?
This is the actual one, yes.
So is there talk of that getting, whether it's in on a wall at Discmania or the PDGA Hall of Fame, where is that disc? Maybe eBay? No. Where is that disc going to be? Is that just going to be in a personal collection of yours?
Yeah, I got my little shelf right here with my glass-blown trophy from last year and then some couple other trophies. This disc is right beside those.
Very cool.
I'll keep it for, I don't want to give it away at all.
No, there's no one.
No, you can give it away next year.
Yeah,
when you beat it with a different disc, see?
That could be.
And you can pass it on to Smashbox.
So next time you go out and you compete in any distance competition, will that very disc come with you and you may try and throw that one as well, or will you replace that?
I haven't really thought about that. Since I don't have so many of these really nice ones, I might take it and just throw it again.
What's the exact weight on it?
It's a 157.
157.
Huh.
That's what it says. I don't really know what it exactly is.
Sure.
Sometimes it's like 1 or 2 grams off.
Yeah, a couple grams off.
So last year you were deep in the game with Avery and traveling all around the country, obviously internationally. We talked to him last week about some of his plans. How do you see the relationship going this year with him being a brand new dad and kind of bouncing around, trying to get back to Oklahoma as often as he can? How is that going to impact your plans? And well, I guess politely I'll ask, have you replaced him? Are you just going to get somebody else to fill in his spot? What's your plan?
Someone less strict about your McDonald's habits.
Yeah, he told us about that.
Oh, wow. He never took me to McDonald's, though. We went one time in 1 year.
He said he would let you go once when you won, I believe is what it was.
Yeah, it was a special day for me.
There's breaking the record, and there's going to McDonald's.
Yeah, I mean, you could if you had that...
The Happy Meal next to the disc?
It would probably be still intact right next to the disc. But no, how are your plans going to shape up for this year?
Yeah, so obviously Avery being not as present this year as he was last year for me, of course, he's a dad, and I'm really happy for him. And his kid is really alive, and it's all doing good, and it's just all cool. And I can't wait to meet the kid. Yeah, I've talked to Avery a bit over the week, and we're having some plans. I don't know how much I can already tell, but not really replacing him, just like adding another person, which is also not clear which person it is yet, but there's a couple of options.
But, are you taking any applications? You know, anyone out there want to just hop in and ride along, or?
Yeah, how easygoing would you be to adding a new person? Are you easy to get along with in that way?
Yeah, I think I'm pretty easy to get along with.
Okay.
Touring is pretty fun, and yeah, it's pretty easy to get along with most disc golfers.
I'll ask it this way. Who on the tour has more fun than you right now?
Oh, my God. Well, last year's tour, I probably had the most fun because everything was, like, new for me. Mm-hmm. And I got to see all these new places, meet all these new people, and... Yeah, every course was like new and special for me, and for all the other guys, it was like a routine and just what they do. So yeah, but this year, I will see how it goes. Okay. My plans right now actually look like I'm flying home on Monday after the memorial back to Germany and staying there for 2 months, and then coming back for Glassblown.
Oh wow!
But I'm trying to change that right now. I was working on that today.
What's the reason that you either are going home or that you want to...
The reason is because I'm like not on a visa here right now. I have a Canadian passport because my dad is Canadian.
Okay.
So I can stay here for 6 months without any kind of visa. But because I'm making money here and traveling around and like supporting a company, of course... The government wants me to, like, yeah, always know what I do, how much money sure. I make, where I'm at, when, and what these tournaments are. So I'm trying to get, like, a pro athlete visa at the moment.
Okay.
And that's, like, way more of an hassle than it should be.
Welcome to bureaucracy.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I know in 2000...
Yeah, and my passport is expiring.
Okay. Okay. And I was just going to say, to that point, I remember talking to Ragna. It was after the 2013 Worlds in Indiana, and she said, like, literally the next day she was getting on a plane and going home, and I said, why so quickly? And she said the exact same thing. She had a sports passport at the sure. time, but she still had to go back and get it renewed or do whatever. And so that's when I had first heard of that. So a couple of questions that came in, and I'm sure you get asked about distance, and that's exactly why you guys are doing the Deep in the Game clinics, and I highly recommend people sign up for those so they can get one-on-one advice from you. But a couple of I thought were pretty good questions that came in earlier once we announced you were going to be on the show. Chris Cobb, huge fan and loyal listener, and we really appreciate everything Chris is doing out in Arizona. He says, what is the most common mistake you see amateurs making that prevent them from throwing big distance shots? Is there something you could say that you see a lot of people doing that's just...
There's a lot of main like basic mistakes I see. The most common one is probably the reach back and the way they pull their disc across their chest. The biggest mistake in the reach back you can make is like bending your elbow and not extending your arm.
Okay.
Like the arm extension is really key to get like a max reach back to create the slingshot and speed. And when you pull through, so many people just rotate their shoulders and leave their arm kind of straight and then just like sling the disc and like try to throw with their arm instead of their whole body. The arm needs to, like, you have to drive your elbow and then snap open, and then you will get this snap and this where it looks so effortless. Just reach back, extend your arm, drive your elbow, open up a little later, and then it'll just come out way quicker.
Okay, perfect. I was going to say, if anybody wants to see this form that he's talking about done poorly, just watch me throw. I know I do not extend. I don't extend my arm back. I usually have a nice bend in the at the elbow,
yep.
And I usually extend my my hand upward instead of flat. So yeah, just watch me throw, and you'll know exactly what you shouldn't be doing.
But if they want to watch what they should be doing, I know Simon released a video a month or two ago now with Spin TV about max distance.
The max distance one, yeah. With the good outtakes in the end.
Yeah, those were pretty good. I think you made me laugh, that's for sure. That's tough.
So speaking of entertaining videos, one thing we did briefly touch on last week, and now here you are, you're doing, you know, somersaults on trampolines and then making putts. Is that part of all your normal practice routine? That's how you really get in the groove for 2015?
I just love using my Instagram for like crazy videos like that. Just making something look easy, which is actually really hard. And of course, most people realize that it's not a first take, but I've actually been doing it all day. And yeah, I'm just having fun with it. I just love doing crazy stuff and then posting it and just see how people react to that. Like this video I did in this skate ramps with my like freestyle catches. That it was like a 10-minute thing, and I thought I would just post it, and like people went nuts about it. Like, dude, that's the coolest thing I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. I was not expecting that kind of feedback, so yeah, that was really cool, and it just makes it even more fun to do it.
Yeah, and we talked about that on the show as well. I mean, when any of our top pros are posting these things, like you said, you can make it look kind of easy, although it may take you half a day to do. And that actually brings me to my next point, which is, you and Mr. Macbeth have a really fun, jovial, you know, pretty lighthearted, we'll say rivalry, at least in social media. Tell everyone what that's all about.
Yeah, over this this off season, we kind of went back and forth on our Instagrams a bit, and just like with comments and whatever. But it's all totally friendly, and we really get along well. And he called me on a foot fault at the Aussie Open in the final round, and that like gave him a little more heat. And people were discussing about that, and like on my trampoline video, people were commenting like, "Oh, that's a foot fault," and stuff like that. So that was pretty funny. I actually met Paul on Sunday. Like Pasadena is not far from here; it's like 40 minutes. And I drove down to Huntington Beach, where he's actually from. Mm-hmm. Just played his home course there, Huntington Beach. And just wanted to meet up with John, his brother. Mm-hmm. And Paul was there too. I didn't even know he wasn't there. He drove down after the tournament. And like the first thing he said to me after he came out of his huge new truck, like, "Hey, Simon, where were you this weekend? I thought you were coming to lose." that was like the first thing he said to me. And I was like, "Oh, really, Paul? That's nice."
Well, and the funny part, I mean, most people who know Paul know that he's very humble. He's not a real cocky guy at all. Yeah. For he's so successful. But yet to see him kind of challenge you and challenge Brody Smith and some of the people that he's really, you know, goes back and forth with, that it's all in good fun, and he's, you know, he's not trying to be too mean by it or anything. What was, and again, we talked about it on the show, what was that like when he had called that foot fault? You know, we don't see a lot of pros, you know, sometimes having especially when you're good friends with them, it's really hard sometimes for pros to make that call and, you know, make a rule infraction on someone else or call it. What was going through your head when that had happened?
It was actually the first time I've ever been called on a foot fault in a tournament. Hmm. So, and I've known from, like, experiences that people get really weird and, like, edgy when they get called on something. And that's, like, totally not how it should be. I mean, we're playing by rules. And if I break a rule, then I should try again and do it better. So, but it was off the tee box, and I was like, how do I foot fault off a tee and don't notice? And I obviously rewatched the video a couple of times and like freeze framed it. And I was like really close. I was kind of thinking like, if it was so close, why would you call it? And it was the final round and I was playing good. But of course, if he thought it was a foot fault, then I think it's the right call.
Okay. Well, and that's great to hear you say, because a lot of people think, you know, so-and-so is just trying to work me
or
get over on somebody. And, you know, Paul, if there's one guy that we know is playing by the rules and wants the rules played by all the time for himself and others, you know, Paul is certainly one of those kind of guys. He's just really stand up in that way. So, it was interesting. It was definitely interesting for people to talk about and to see – how do you think we can remedy that? A lot of people say, oh, I don't want to call someone. And I know we hear Brian Graham at big events always say, you know, you're essentially breaking a rule if you're not calling the rules on your competitors. How do you think we could, you know, is it any different overseas, or how can we handle it here in the U.S. to be better at it?
It's so hard. I would feel, even if I would call a footfall, for some reason, I would also feel a little weird about it. Just to see them struggling after I called them on something just wouldn't be, it just feels wrong. Mm-hmm. Because what I noticed when I got called, I wasn't like thinking about the call anymore. I was just worried about every next throw footfalling again.
Sure.
And that's where it gets tough, because like everybody footfalls probably in every round, like at one point, just slightly.
Sure. I think it's a lot of times you'll see that on a second fairway throw. You know, and trying to plant, you know, if you've got another drive, trying to plant behind a mini, you know, you may miss it by an inch or two. But I think you're right. I think people do it quite a bit more often than they think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've actually never called anybody, I think, even though I see multiple footfalls every tournament, even by the best players, I see it all the time, but.
Yeah, is that?
I don't know why I don't call them.
Yeah, I was gonna say, is that something you think you should change, or are you kind of? Is it just not in your nature? Are you waiting for somebody else to call it so you can second it? Is that?
Yeah, kind of. I don't know. Yeah, I think we should have like a.
Yeah, I don't mean to put you on the spot here, but
no, that's what we do. When you step inside the Smashbox, Simon, we are gonna grill you every time on the rules.
No, it's. I understand the question, and I ask myself the same question, actually, sure. But I can't answer it yet, really.
But, I mean, and you're clearly not alone, because if you're seeing these, other pros are probably seeing them and not calling them, and it's, you know, and then I think that's what makes it more difficult when someone actually does call one. If they were called more frequently, the pressure wouldn't be there, the concern wouldn't be there, it would just be another step of the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's also that we're calling our direct competitors, because when we're on the same card, our scores are close, and then every call has like a direct effect on our game and on our score, and like we're competing pretty much out there for not a lot of money, and like every dollar counts, and every shot could mean like $200, and we're playing for our existence pretty much.
And some of the comment coming out on the board for everyone out there, people are talking about whether the rules should be changed, you know, and how challenging it is to call or not make the call. I guess one of the questions would be then, do you feel like there should be, maybe even at our, specifically starting at our largest events, should there be a non-playing official that is walking along with you guys that's basically, you know, just like they have in golf, an official for every card? I know it'd be tough, but maybe the top two or three cards at an NT, do you feel like, you know, maybe that's what we should have? Would that make it easier?
Yeah, I was thinking about that. It will, I think it will make it easier, but it could also mean that just way more footfalls or any kind of violations are going to be called, and then it gets a whole new game. Mm-hmm. Like, so many sports are just fouls and fouls, like, every minute, and disc golf is should not become that, for sure.
Okay, so... as they say in NASCAR, Simon's telling us, if you ain't cheating, you ain't trying. So that's pretty much what he's telling us tonight.
We are grilling Simon.
Nah.
Is this how we treat our guest who was kind enough to step in when, you know,
was that what I was saying?
That's what I heard. I don't know. I'm deaf in one ear. Maybe it's a language barrier thing. I don't know. That's what I heard.
So, Simon, is it safe to say that maybe the Glass Blown Open is the event you're looking forward to the most this year? Or are there any other ones maybe that you... that you're looking to hit?
Wow, I'm looking forward to every event, but especially the 2 weeks in Europe, where we have the back-to-back majors in Sweden and Finland. Those 2 weeks are going to be insane, and like, there's so much going to be going on, and Jussi is going to put on a pretty awesome show for that. And of course, Worlds, as every year. Last year was actually my first Worlds, so looking forward to try harder this year. And Glass Blown, of course, for me being the reigning champion, and I have a chance to defend my title. I'm obviously looking forward to that.
Any courses that really stick out in your head in the last year? You traveled across the country. I know you got to play, and I know a lot of times you're focused on tournament courses. You don't just get to get off, you know, at, you know, a random course and go out and play as much as you'd probably like to. But any courses in particular that really stood out for you this year as you traveled cross country?
Yeah, I was a little disappointed with most American courses because a lot of them are really not good.
Okay.
Sorry, what? Sorry, America.
No, that's
sorry, America. I apologize.
Yeah,
to
apologizing
all of you.
To America. What didn't you like about them? I mean, what would you like to see changed or more courses to? That's not necessarily.
The thing is, yeah, I'm traveling around with like the most critical. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's the right word. Person. Yeah. When it comes to course design and tee pads and baskets, Avery yes. Jenkins, like he has so high expectations on the courses we play because he just wants to be professional. He's been working in this sport for 15 years and just working for it to be better, be bigger, be more professional. And then when we get to like a whatever course and then it's just like crappy tee pads, like leaning baskets, and then there's like a tournament on a national tour with crappy tee pads and leaning baskets, it's just frustrating. And I kind of noticed myself over the year like becoming like Avery a bit of like just looking at everything like with a critical eye, like, oh my god, this is terrible. Yeah. But yeah, a lot of places of course are also really nicely done, and that like, you really see if the course designer or whoever works on the course has put effort into it and a lot of thoughts, and it really makes it way better if it's done well. And what stood out for me was both Milo courses, just for my game, how they play, and it just looks beautiful. I love, those were my two favorite courses of the year.
So, well, there's one more thing that I think we need to talk about, and I think we can make the announcement now.
Yeah, why not?
Well, we've got a bunch of announcements tonight. We've got other people that are going to chime in with announcements. But one of the announcements that we'd like to make is that after talking to you and three mm-hmm. others,
yep.
we have, in fact, finalized the four people that will be battling it out at Vista Del Camino's course on Monday morning. So just 6 days from now, wow. Simon, along with Ooh. His original guest in our original guest from tonight, Kale Leviska,
yep.
along with Jonny McRae.
Wow.
And
last but not least, Nate Sexton. So
nice.
Those yeah. are going to be the four. I know. I don't even think we had the final one lined up for when I talked to you earlier. But those, I think we can officially deem this like the nice guy card.
Yeah, there's.
This will be the nicest battle you little fellas will ever have. seriously, probably four of the most dynamic yet
professional
and mild mannered and exciting players out there. We're just super excited to have you guys. This will be our second.
Yeah, we're looking forward to a fun show.
Yes, and
I didn't even know till right now who I'm playing with except for Kale.
Yeah,
but oops, that was a wrong button.
No, now okay. You know. Everybody, okay,
I have never ever played around with Jonny McRae.
Really?
It's like over all the tournaments we played last year, and we always finished like within 3 strokes. And throughout the tournament, we were tied or had a 1-stroke difference. I have not played a single round with Jonny McRae ever.
Well, there you go. And Gary Greason, Gary Greason on the board says that we should video that.
Oh, really?
I hadn't thought of that.
That's a great idea.
Just kidding, Gary. No, so if you guys didn't already know,
we just make these guys put on shows for us. We just go. We don't tell anybody.
No, the whole premise of this, yep. thanks to the guys over at Legacy who had the brilliant idea last year when we yep. did Battle at Blue Lake. This was a brainchild of Steve and Bamba Rico. And we're going with 4 new players, and they're going to have the Battle at Vista. And as we just said, Jonny McRae, Kale Leviska, Nate Sexton, and our guest right now, Simon Lizotte. So all 4 of them, we're looking to go live at 11 a.m. Mountain Time.
Okay.
So whatever that means, whatever time zone you're in, but it's going to be live at 11 a.m. Mountain Time right here on SmashBoxxTV.
Yep.
We're expecting a huge gallery of people to be out at Vista to take it in if they want to be truly live and watching it on site. And then if you can't make it, and you want to sit, maybe it's at Duke's, or you want to sit at home.
Watch it on your phone. Watch it maybe
at work.
I don't know if we can get it to play in Duke. Yeah. I don't know if we can get it to play in Duke's. We've tried things like that before, and it's not always been the most successful.
They're, what, 8 or 9 hours ahead in Germany? So maybe we'll get a huge hometown crowd to cheer you on from across the pond, so to speak.
That'd be great.
I'll advertise it for sure.
Yeah, so that is, in fact, one of our big announcements for tonight. Again, we've been talking about this battle for a couple months now, but to have these four gentlemen joining us, it's just going to be awesome. Simon, I know I've heard from you, and I've also heard from Nate at one time or another, that when you guys can let loose and have some fun and try to put on a show, you guys can be a little bit more aggressive and try some fun stuff. So I think that course will let you do that.
Yeah, I hope I can play well. Usually, like in practice and fun rounds, I'm not that good of a player because I just try crazy stuff.
Well, we don't mind.
People think in tournaments I do crazy stuff, but in practice I do really crazy stuff. So we'll see how it goes.
Well, we did have a conversation. So for everyone that knows, Fountain Hills, we're going to probably see two other live rounds out there throughout the week, so we already know we're going to be covering that course pretty well.
Yep.
And it's a little bit shorter, and it's probably hard to be aggressive. And then
no one wants to lose their plastic at Fountain during a fun round.
Yeah,
that's what I was thinking.
And out at Fiesta Lakes, we just know it's going to be really busy. They're talking about people getting on the course after 1 or 2 o'clock both Monday and Tuesday and not being able to access them until that time. So, yes, the decision was actually quite thought out as to why we're doing Vista.
Yep.
They're only playing that course one other time during the week. So this is a good time for people to see the course and get a little bit of practice in. So we are looking forward to it. Gosh, you...
Me too.
You, who throws a roller further, Sexton or yourself?
I don't know, but I would guess me.
Oh, I like that. Fair enough. The confidence.
I know Nate throws a really good roller. Heck, I've seen Jonny throw a great roller. So any predictions now that you know all four of those players? Any predictions how things might go down?
Well, I've never played with Jonny, so I don't even know his game, but from a couple of videos.
Mm-hmm.
Kale, pretty conservative player, like complete opposite from my game. And I think I've only played one round ever with Nate. And he is pretty on top of his game, I think, at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
So he's on fire. I'm feeling really good after Aussie Open, which went pretty good for me, at least two rounds did.
Yeah, I heard you just had the bad end of the first round, was it? The last couple holes you were saying on Facebook that you just... You were shooting lights out and just ran into a little bump in the road on two or three holes.
Yeah, I wasn't shooting lights out. I was seven down with four holes to play, and then I finished with four over on the last four holes. Really, really bad. It was for everyone who hasn't seen it, you should be glad to not have seen it. It was really bad.
That's usually how I say about my rounds, and I have to watch
them. I had my first 90-degree throw ever in my life. Like, I grip locked it 90 degrees in the wrong direction.
Oh,
wow.
It happens.
Well, apparently not too much, but it does
happen to some. Too much.
Yeah, well.
All right. We know that you have some amazing supporters from all over the place. Go ahead and give everyone a shout out and your thanks to any supporters that you have out there, companies or otherwise.
Yeah. First one, obviously, Discmania, who has been supporting me for 3 years now, and they treat me like a train. I can't thank them enough. I live in this Discmania home right now in Rancho, where I can live for free, just living a life of disc golf style. And it's so cool. And they're doing so much for me. And grip equipment, their bags, best bag out there. And yeah, their support last year was actually really important and really good. And then my latest sponsor, Dude. I love that name. It's down under Disc Evolution, and yeah, it's an Australian disc golf apparel company, and in the Aussie Open, they just gave me some clothes, and they're going to support me from now on, and yeah, it's really, really high quality stuff, and I can't wait to promote that, and I think everyone should have a shirt that says Dude on it.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, dude.
Jeez.
All right. Yeah. Well, Simon, we appreciate you joining us here tonight. We thank you so much as well, not only for agreeing to join us in the battle at Vista, but also for the very short notice to replace Kale, who couldn't join us today. So I do appreciate that. It actually worked out well that we could make both announcements here today. So we do thank you, and we hope that you travel safely over from Rancho over to Phoenix. And I'll probably run into you in probably 3 or 4 days over at the Fountain or Vista or one of those courses while you're practicing. Maybe you can help do a little pre-tournament work with us and the camera crew. Someone said that you're good in front of a camera. Does that sound right?
Sometimes.
Well, we had you for the
Bowling Green Amateurs.
Doing all the warm-ups with your putters, and people loved that. People wanted to... we asked Avery last week, and I just want to get it out there. How far do you think you can throw a putter?
If you could just unleash, and let's say you were playing in a putters only distance competition, what do you feel like you could throw?
I'm thinking not that far. Well, I threw a mini 529.
Yeah, you threw a mini 529.
So you would think I could throw a putter like reasonably farther, but I don't think that's the case. Like maybe 500 feet.
Oh, maybe.
Okay. Depending on luck.
Okay. Yeah, luck, wind, all that other good stuff you have for it, working for you.
The mini shot was actually a zero wind, by the way.
Okay.
Do you think that
was pure luck?
Pure luck. Do you think that helped that there was zero wind? Or do you think...
It might have helped, yeah. I don't think, maybe if you throw really light minis, wind might help, but I was throwing these pretty heavy Innova drivers.
Sure. All right. Cool.
Yeah, it was like 6 mph tailwind, so not a lot.
Hmm. That's
and
all right.
The throw was like, I've never ever thrown a mini like that before and after.
Is it mostly the same form as your drive? Or
exact
just...
same grip, exact same throw, just a smaller disc.
Okay.
Yeah. I use a 4-finger grip. It's the first day I've ever tried that, and it worked. It works. You should try it.
Well, next time we want you to practice and see if you can break that record.
Yeah.
All right.
All right. All right, Simon, thanks again for joining us tonight. We're going to send you off, and again, we'll see you in a few days, and we look forward to seeing you as well at the battle at Vista. Have a great night, pal.
Yeah. Take it easy, guys.
Take care.
Dude.
And there you have it, Simon Lizotte. I don't think I'm going to start calling him the dude, but...
Yeah.
Simon Lizotte, let's just say he's having a really good time. And
someone mentioned how, Jonny McRae's goal was to have the most fun, and that's a battle right there between the two of them.
Yes, him, and I know Nate Sexton's really pumped about being on his tour this year, traveling around with Paul McBeth, and he's really looking forward to that. Kind of his first year on the tour, and I'm sure he's going to have a really good time with it. And Kale, he doesn't necessarily get in a van or an RV, so to speak, and travel around the country as vigorously as we're going to see these gentlemen. But Kale's always out there with a smile on his face, having a good time. Some people call him super dreamy. That might be me, but
I think it's just you.
But we know Kale's always out there having a really good time when he's out on the tour. So with that, let's move on. Again, thanks to Simon for joining us, especially with not a lot of time or advance notice, I guess we'll say.
Yeah.
Let's move into, we're going to have Nate Heinel joining us shortly. We're going to be talking to him in a few minutes and getting some pretty cool updates and exciting things from him. Let's check in with,
I was going to say, this can't be super exciting for them. They wanted to come in and see how this works and the way we have this set up. They don't hear our guests, no. So they only get our side of it, which...
I mean, how exciting? That should be extra exciting.
Yeah, that's what you call it. Next time we'll have a little speaker set up for them so they can hear the guests.
Any questions from the gallery?
Can you replay that interview?
You can replay that interview whenever you want.
Good question. Check out the any of your local podcast apps. You'll be able to replay that. Again, one of the beauties of the system that we do have is that if you were, in fact, sitting and watching right now, watching live, just you could hit the pause button. You could go grab your you know, if the pizza man's at the door, you can hit pause and then hit play again and get caught up.
Yeah, we're just waiting. We're waiting for Nate to call us. I don't have Nate's contact for some reason. I know we've talked to him before, but
we'll have to get his Skype info. We'll get that taken care of. We're going to move on to a couple other things, including some news and social media around the sport. We've kind of touched on a few of these things. Like we said, we just it was great to catch up with Simon, you know, to talk to him about his funny videos that we've talked about here on the show.
I'm trying to think, like, what can he do next? He's done the skate park. He's done the trampoline.
Yeah, I'm sure he – when you throw that far – you can come up with games that none of us would ever think of.
Yeah.
I don't know. Throwing over water towers comes to mind.
Sure.
You know, it's coming up with all sorts of feats and games that other people couldn't even dream of doing. Those are things that come to mind for me. I know in talking to Jonny McRae a few weeks ago, I think at an event, or no, maybe you were talking about throwing over the water tower.
Trying to hit the bottom of the water tower is what Jonny used to
say. So there's all sorts of fun things that you can come up with there. What we're also... going to talk about social media. He's there every week, and I don't know if it's getting crazier or not, but Scott Stokely, he's still definitely working
out. I'm just going to say it, wackadoodle. He's the nicest guy. He's a wackadoodle.
Him and his girlfriend, Kristen.
She's a wackadoodle.
Are having a really good time.
Wackadoodle.
They're having a really good time on the tour. As of last night, a night or two ago, he talked about how Paul McBeth is talking to him through the fillings in his teeth.
Yes.
And there was a video of them in bed, not Paul, but Kristen not Scott in bed together, and Paul's name had come up, and he continues to call out McBeth, and he wants to go against the best and be the best, so he's going to take on the best, and he's going to take on the beast. But then this morning, there was a video discussing Scott getting checked into a mental institution.
Yeah. I mean, first there was just the checking of a hospital.
Yeah, correct.
It didn't say
and then
anything.
Further, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then later she comes on and basically, you know, sits behind and she looks upset and, you know, and more or less,
Yeah, so there's discussion about it. Well, we're going to probably move on from there, but just so you know, he's in the news.
Wackadoodle.
Some people are really into the stories. Some people are not, including you know, even some of our viewers and listeners out there. If you want to take it all in, I know there's now a Scott Stokely fan page. You can go take it all in if you're interested in reading up and following along with the stories. They're out there. It's just a matter of what you choose to... digest or it's interesting. One of the things that I know we are going to talk about probably more in depth at another time, but there is a video, and I'm going to throw out a quick blurb. Personally, there's a video out there that's called This Is Disc Golf, and it's really a highlight reel. And
it's getting a lot of play.
It's getting a lot of play. In fact, I believe it's received more than 15,000 views in the last 24 hours, which in terms of disc golf is pretty significant. Yeah. It's a 4-minute video. And within at least our somewhat small media group of disc golfers, I know myself and Joe Height and John Dusler at Disc Golf Planet and Stu Mullenberg, the photographer, and a few others, Cool Daddy Slick Breeze, we've had some conversation in one of our media groups that we have talking about some of the legalities of video. And this can be obviously said of photography as well, Jenny Cook and Stu Mullenberg, like I said. And this individual, who I don't even know personally, had taken a bunch of really good clips from throughout the year and then assembled them into what is really this highlight reel. And at the end, and in the notes, they had credited Disc Golf Planet and myself and one or two other people. I forget everyone that was listed there. They had wrote and said, you know, coverage or you know, kind of crediting us.
Yeah.
However, I think the real sticking point here that we can kind of leave it at is there was permission was never really asked.
Correct. They more or less downloaded your videos from YouTube, chopped them up, put a highlight reel together, put it out there, credited you at the end, didn't ask anything.
Correct. And so the question becomes legalities,
yep,
and copyrights and all those things, and there can be a huge argument or discussion that can take place on the message board in itself. This is something we're going to tackle later, but the long and short of it is, don't do that. All right.
Ask permission before you use anyone's video.
Ask and get permission. Yes, don't just ask and assume.
Ask and get permission. Most of the people out there, you know, are very friendly, and if you tell them what you're going to do, more than likely they'll give you permission as long as you're credited. You know, just ask ahead of time. That's really what people are saying.
Yeah, that's pretty much the long and short of it. Some people may say no, even if you do ask them permission, but yeah, always ask for permission. If you want to use someone's video or a clip or a photograph, that happens all the time in disc golf. Yeah. We have so many talented, already underappreciated and underpaid photographers.
Yep.
And then somebody just takes their photo and says, well, I just made it my profile pic, or, you know, I just had it put on this, or I had it done with that. Just ask for permission. It's always the best way to go. I've had three different people from two different countries reach out to me in the last 24 hours and say, here's what I'm looking to try and do. Can I use such and such clips? Mm-hmm. I said, no, I'm just kidding. I said, you know, it was no problem. But again, it's really disheartening to, even if it is a good video like this gentleman made, it's disheartening to just be sitting there and all of a sudden watching your work and he just put it all together. And
sure.
Maybe you have to be a creator yourself, and I'm not even that good of one, but you have to be a creator yourself to understand how that feels. You really feel kind of robbed by that. So long story short, don't do that. Ask for permission, and we'll dive into that, you know, in a future episode, maybe talking with one of our lawyer friends in another segment. So
you know who we have on the line waiting for another night of 1,000 announcements?
Taylor Swift. T-Swift?
He kind of looks like her.
A little bit around the eyes. No, I'd spend more time with him if he did. All right. With that being said, welcome to the show, Mr. Ledgestone himself, Nate Heinold. How are we doing tonight, Nate?
I am good. How are you guys doing?
We're doing wonderful. We're excited to hear what you have to announce as far as the Ledgestone and other announcements.
I sing? I mean, I know some Taylor Swift songs, so can I sing?
I think you should.
Shake it off.
Shake it off. What do you got for us?
Sorry, I was thinking of Katy Perry, so never mind.
Okay,
so
go with Katy Perry. We're cool with that.
No, unless he comes riding in on a giant lion, no Katy Perry.
I'll come riding in on a big buzz. No, you know, no pun intended. So.
There you go. We're gonna hear you roar. All right, what do you got for us?
Yeah. So we have a couple things here. You know, I'll just jump right into one of the really fun things is that I'm pulling up my Excel file here, but we are officially going to announce that we will add $65,000 to the pro purse for the Ledgestone Insurance Open this year, presented by Discraft. So that's kind of the big catch-all number there. So
hashtag OMG.
I was about to say, really, you're pulling up Excel. How exciting can it be? Yeah,
that's what I was thinking too.
But when those numbers are on the spreadsheet, I can understand how exciting that would be.
So in the words of AJ, hashtag owning, hashtag ledgestoning, I'm going to go ahead and...
Well done. I like that. Hashtag ledgestoning. Yes.
I'm going to post this tomorrow. I just pulled up the Excel file, but first place in MPO is 6,600, second place 4,500, all the way down to 25th place gets 1,000. So, and we'll take care of the girls as well. First place in female 3,000, second place 2,200. So... It's not just for the guys and the pro masters. We'll take care of them as well. First place pro masters 1,600. So, it's gonna be a fun event. So
a few quick clarifications. One, you're talking about adding $65,000 to the purse. So that's astonishing. Two, some of those projected numbers you just gave us are also with the idea that those divisions are basically filling or selling out. Is that correct?
Yeah, no, all that, you know, assumes a full field, but I think it's safe to say I imagine we'll have a full field of professionals, but I could be wrong, but those are assuming a full field. And if we have a full field, the total purse would be $115,000, just under that, actually. So,
wow. That's does that include is that $115,000 with or without the amateur side of things?
No, that's without the amateur side. So
okay, and for what it's worth, I remember sitting in a PDGA board room or a PDGA board discussion meeting, summit meeting in 2005, and there was a PDGA update, and the TD, who was John Dusler at the time, said he wanted to have Worlds give away $100,000, have the first $100,000 Worlds purse in 2005, and I think they came up a little short of that. Which just to compare numbers, yeah, and you're sure. talking about $115,000 NT purse. That's astonishing.
I think the first $100,000 purse may have been last year. I know Charlotte was about $98,000, so the USDGC has been up there, but never quite there. But that certainly wasn't our intention, just to break records, but it just happened to work out that way.
We just happen to break some,
whatever,
35 or 40 year old records in terms of how much money we're paying out. One of the coolest and most exciting additions to that is a $10,000 charitable contribution. Tell us about it.
Yeah, so we're going to give at least $10,000 to St. Jude. We've worked with them for, this is our third year now with the PDGA and St. Jude working together on their event in California. We wanted to step up our contribution. So Ledgestone and Discraft will give at least $10,000 combined, and we're going to do some other stuff to try to raise more than that. So, and you know, we work closely with St. Jude, and so we're going to have some kids out at the event and hopefully work with some top players to get them down to the local hospital here, which is right in Peoria. So definitely not just a cash grab. You know, we're going to have the big St. Jude donation, and we want to do some other things with some clinics. And the AM player pack, you know, I won't even go into that, but it'll be mind-boggling. So it's not just about the cash. We definitely want to do something for this great charity. So,
and just think, instead of $10,000, it could be like, if you didn't wear such a nice suit, that could be like a $12,000 contribution.
Wow.
No, we're just kidding. You're looking good, buddy.
No, I came from it. I went to a city council meeting tonight, so that's, I'm not dressed up for you at all. I would never dress up for you. So
yeah, right. Yeah, right. We know you would.
He dressed down for you.
Yes, I took my, I had a tie on tonight, so I took it off. So
down, Justin Timberlake. All right. Yeah. So what was the city council meeting? Were they giving you keys to the whole county, or what were they doing?
They were naming me mayor, just like in, you know, like just mayor pro tempore. So no, the city council meeting was getting a big temporary course approved for the tournament, actually. So, and just as part of running a big tournament, I'm constantly meeting with park districts and city councils and that kind of stuff. When you're going to bring up, you know, close to 1,000 people to a park for the last day, and they want to know details of where people are going to park and where they're going to be eating at and all kinds of things, and so that's what that was for. So
I'm a tournament director myself. Johnny V pretends to help once in a while, but we know what kind of monumental effort it is to put on a successful C-tier or B-tier, even an A-tier. Give everyone just a
AM Worlds,
or which, an AM Worlds, but yeah. Give everyone just a real quick snapshot, because I told you this last year. If you give away all this money and you do such a great job, everybody's gonna want it every weekend. At every tournament, and realistically, we're just not there as a sport. You're one of a kind. Give everyone a little bit of insight as to the kind of the effort and the energy you have to put in, and how are you going to not burn out, you know, in following years?
Yeah, Bob from Discraft, he's the Discraft team manager. He does not allow me to date, and so he's spreading rumors about me, so I can't date because of the time that I put in. It almost is a full-time job. Right now I'm putting in about 35 hours a week on the tournament, mm-hmm. and we're 6 months away. A lot of fundraising, but I'm constantly responding to emails and messages, meeting with city councils, park districts. I'm trying to get new sponsors, selling fundraiser discs. I think last time I checked, we had sold with my team over $45,000 worth of fundraiser discs. And so a lot of time just with all of that, I'm out at the course doing some design work, because we have 8 courses this year, and we're making some changes to make them better. You know, working with getting temporary tee pads for 2 temp courses and new baskets, and replacing baskets at 3 courses. And so it's a lot of work, but a lot of it is responding to messages and phone calls and talking to sponsors and talking to companies. And Just a lot of late nights. So.
Well, and again, we appreciate it. Everyone's going to appreciate. There's no doubt about that. But and everyone on the board is talking about you raising the bar and how great this is, and everybody agrees with that. But yeah. Again, I'm going to reiterate, this isn't a sustainable model for every sure. tournament director across the country. You're going above and beyond. There's no doubt about that. And you've got a great support system and network, and you're doing great things. You got great connections. And as much as we'd love to see this every single weekend somewhere, it's not sure. fair that everyone says, well, God, my local TD should be doing that too. You know, most TDs yeah. can't sure. do this.
It's a huge amount of work.
I would say that at this point in time, disc golf is not there at all. I'm spending way too much time on this event, honestly, mm-hmm. that's just the truth. So, and you know, certainly that, you know, the effort that I'm putting in is not you can't do it without bigger sponsors. And but I think to do that, we need more grassroots clinics, schools, more charity stuff, and that'll come. But yeah, you're right. It is definitely not sustainable for someone like me who does not make any money off the tournament. I don't take any money from the tournament. It all goes to the players or St. Jude. To do that, it's not sustainable. And yeah. fortunately, I'm blessed with a very good day job, and Discraft has been phenomenal. I asked them to do something, and they say, we can do this, and we can do this as well for you. So, and that's a good seg maybe to this.
To our next announcement.
Maybe another yeah. announcement.
I told you, night of a thousand announcements.
I'm ledge stoning again. So, but Discraft, we're doing some fundraiser discs, and then they recently, Bob and I and Discraft had the idea to do a new blend of plastic to take kind of two current blends. And so we came up with what we're calling TI Flex Plastic. So that's what's coming out here in about 5 or 6 weeks. And so we're going to do TI Flex. It combines titanium and Discraft, the Flex Plastic, and really combines the best characteristics of both. I actually have a prototype right here with me of a disc we may not even run. It's a TI Flex Force. Hmm. So it's, as I said, it's not as flexible as G-Star by any means, but it's very grippy, very durable. We're releasing a Buzz and a Buzz SS and a Nuke and a lot of other great things. We're doing some non-TI Flex stuff, a Crystal Flex Sparkle Ringer and Crystal Flex Tracker. We're bringing back the CT Challenger. It's the Crazy Tough Challenger. So, so we're doing some great things, and Discraft has really stepped up. And so those will be available here in about 6 weeks, releasing, but that's it's a great feeling plastic. I've thrown it. It feels great. It's very grippy. And so that's coming here in about 6 weeks. And if you're a vendor or if you sell discs and want to get in on the program, we do have some spots left. Contact me and I'll get you with Justin Jernigan, who's kind of helped me with that, or you can contact Justin directly. So
awesome. So TI Flex Plastic. You know, I know Discraft has been, like you said, they've been a huge supporter of this, helping with all of this fundraising and really working with you with some limited discs. Yeah. I know that I've worked with you as well to carry some of these limited discs that are really just all benefiting the tournament. So it's great that anybody that's buying some of these discs, whether it's off of you or me or me or you.
or you.
Or me. No, but it's really been great because, again, all of this is helping really fund the overall project, which is, you know, this huge Ledgestone event. So that's and exciting.
And we're offering wholesale pricing to vendors. So it's not like, you know, mm-hmm. we're giving this ridiculously high pricing. If you talk to Justin, we have very good pricing, and these are all limited edition discs. We're releasing over the next 6 months, we're releasing 26 new molds that have never been in certain characteristics, never been released before in those molds, you know, some TI Flex and some other stuff. So you can talk to Justin and sell those and make some money and then help the tournament spread the name and, you know, get us some funds as well. So
yeah, and we've said this before, and a few people asked on the board. Certainly, if you another way to help support Nate and what he's doing, along with all of the Ledgestone, the greater Ledgestone good, if you are in the Illinois, Indiana, Wisconsin area especially, certainly reach out to Nate and get an insurance quote from him. It's the least you can do. Yeah. He is saving thousands of dollars for lots of people all around the country. And I know he's helped out me and he's helped out Dana and then dozens of other people, of golfers specifically. And so if you're at all interested, certainly get a hold of Nate and get yourself a quote. That's the least you can do, is he can quote you out. Just tell him the Disc Golf Guy sent you. And
He'll double the quote.
Yeah. And then I think I get some. No, maybe not.
No.
No, but certainly that's something someone can do is reach out. And then I'm going to also answer a question that we saw on the board, and it does kind of directly pertain to me. I've been working with Nate and the entire Ledgestone Insurance series that's going to be taking place in the Illinois, Wisconsin area throughout the entire year leading up to the culminating event. And registration for the Ledgestone Insurance Open should be available in the early part of March. We're talking, the 2nd or 3rd or 5th? Or when are we talking, Nate?
Yeah, March 2nd.
Yeah, our studio audience knew that, and he's over there flashing the 2 sign, the March 2nd sign. Yeah.
All right.
So March 2nd, if you're rated 990 and above, and March 4th for everybody else. We definitely encourage you to get an iRegistered online account, because you will need that to register. And we do expect, the MPO especially, I would highly recommend registering for that immediately. That will probably fill the quickest. And so definitely get on that. But you will need an iRegistered online account to do that. So.
Correct. And iRegisteredOnline.com is, in fact, my registration service. I've reached out to a couple people, and I've got a great helper that is helping me bring that up to date and up to speed, work with the PDGA's database system, so yep. that kind of like when you went out to the memorial and you use Disc Golf Scene or some of the other services, it will in fact verify that you're a PDGA member, whether you're current or not, because this is a national tour event. So that's exactly what iRegisteredOnline.com is working on, and getting its well overdue revamp, and we're working on that right now. So if it doesn't work on March 2nd, don't call me. Well, okay, you can call me. It'll probably be my fault, but we'll get it up and running for you.
Yep. Oh, I'll post your cell phone if it's not working.
Yeah, thanks.
Not hard to find.
All right, Nate. Any final shots here tonight? I mean, those are some amazing updates. The TI Flex, the $65,000 added cash, the St. Jude at least $10,000 to that charity, if not more. Anything else?
I would just say, you know, Bob's trying to keep me from dating, but if you do know Taylor Swift's number, you mentioned just put her in touch with me. She seems like a nice
I think
girl.
she's probably listening. I mean, I would assume
so.
She was a pick of the week of mine a few weeks ago, so she probably listens now.
She seems more my type than Katy Perry. That lion thing or jaguar or whatever it was, that just kind of turned me off from the program. But
yeah,
she seems like,
I'm sure,
you know.
Yeah, you'd shoot that right down.
Yeah, yeah. I know
you're picky.
You're a little bit more you're a little more conservative. So yeah,
yep,
T Swift exactly. is definitely.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Well, I'll see what I can do. I'll see what I can do.
We'll work on that. So.
All right. Well, Nate, thanks for joining us. Thanks for all the awesome updates. Everyone in the entire disc golf world is I'm sure excited about the Ledgestone and how that's going to go down in August, just a couple of weeks after Worlds. We're honored that Smashbox TV is going to have an involvement with covering some activities throughout the entire week and recording it and putting it out there for the few people that won't be there in attendance. They'll be able to sit at home and watch all the sweet action. So thank you for everything you're doing, pal.
Thanks.
All right. Have a good night. So, yeah, about that slacker Nate.
I mean, really, when he gets on the ball and starts actually putting in some effort into this event,
yeah,
then we'll maybe. Talk.
Yeah.
We'll talk.
65 grand added. I added at least like 300 to the purse I ran in a few tournaments ago. I mean.
You donated like 100 last weekend.
I did. When you play that bad, I guess you could call it a donation.
The past 2 weekends, you've been donating.
All right, shut up. Okay. So a few other quick things we saw in social media. Paige Bjorkas was, in fact, in California at Oak Grove and photographed with Mark Salling. I don't know how he pronounces his last name. He's one of the studs, we'll say, on Glee. And he's been hanging out at the course. He plays there. He bought a disc off Johnny Tompkins of Supreme Flight. And he's been hanging out, and he plays there frequently. Sure. And whether you're a Glee fan or not, doesn't matter. Or a Gleek, I think they call him. But whether you are or not, it's cool that he is a pretty high-profile guy. And the fact that he's out playing disc golf or talking about disc golf on social media.
Yeah.
and, you know, got a picture with Paige Bjerkus, like we said, is really cool. And he's been at a few events. I did talk with my good friend Ben Ferris, who said that Mark was in the gallery. He specifically watched the end of the tournament this weekend, the Wintertime Open.
Oh, cool.
He watched the final few holes during regulation and then stuck around and watched the entire final nine. And then also took a photo with McBath and whatnot. So, I don't, again, it doesn't matter.
He's a fan.
He's a fan of the sport. He's a player of the sport. Yeah. And the fact that we have such a high-profile celebrity out there that's playing and doing what he can.
We've seen this in the past with Kristen Stewart from the Twilight series stuff. And, you know, she's it seems like that those photos get circulated every now and again. And she's out playing. So, Matthew Perry, back when we were
way
young.
Back in the day.
There's a pro golfer. I'm blanking on
Bubba Watson.
Bubba Watson, thank
he's
you.
He's a big, yeah.
Big
so,
disc golfer.
Aaron Rodgers has talked about playing disc golf.
Yeah, he's
golf, so.
Over in California.
Yeah, so it's awesome. It will lead to anything, may or may not, who knows, but just knowing that we have such huge celebrities playing the sport, enjoying the sport, anything could happen from there.
Yeah.
And, you know, maybe I could get Mark on here to, you know, co-anchor with me when we.
Good idea.
Huh? Then just I'm this right up here in the Smashbox
sing
up here.
Song.
Yeah, or something like that. I don't think I'm a Gleek. No, I don't really think I am. so, anyways, one of the really cool things that we did see on social media this last week, and what I know it's a question that gets asked, but do you think there's one thing that may put us on the map in terms of the mainstream world, something positive, hopefully?
Positive, yeah, that'd be a nice change of pace.
Anything in particular that you can think of?
What would put disc golf on the map?
Yeah, that would, I mean, you know, you think could really, you know, quickly.
It could be a big star playing.
Mm-hmm.
It could be just a.
I mean, it's been in the background of the movies.
Correct,
that, you
yeah,
know.
It's been on 22 Jump Street, 21
exactly.
Jump Street,
mm-hmm.
The new ones. I don't think anything like that, just being in background. It could be a really cool, like, a serious documentary could do something like that.
Okay.
Or just a really awesome shot on SportsCenter could help out quite a bit.
Okay, I agree.
But other than that, I mean, just keep moving. Grassroots, as they say. Just keep building it up. We've always made the kind of fantasy of, you know, some big wigs kid who gets into it, whether it's a CEO at some Fortune 500 company or maybe someone over in Silicon Valley, something along those lines that would get into it and maybe just decide they want to throw some weight behind the sport. Because right now, I know out on the West Coast, Ultimate is hugely popular with a lot of the Silicon Valley guys. They've got, you know, clubs and things like that. And that's not more than, you know, a step or two away from disc golf, as we all know. So,
Liz Dorries chimes in saying she wants to be our social media correspondent.
We could arrange something.
We could talk about that, Liz. I know Liz is going to school for things along those lines. Maybe we could.
Good resume builder. We're a good resume builder.
Yeah,
that's what we'll tell you.
We want to be your stepping stone or something. I don't know about that. We'll see. What else do we have? Anything else going on out in the social media world? I mean,
I haven't seen a lot on social media this week. I've been extremely kind of busy with personal stuff. I know work.
Blah, blah, blah.
I know.
Work.
I know.
Other real world stuff. To give everyone kind of a quick recap of our plan next week.
Yes.
I think is definitely
You're
in order.
Flying out Saturday?
Is I'll be right? out flying into directly into Phoenix on Saturday.
Okay.
I moved up my flight actually a day from Sunday over to Saturday just because I want to get out there and start doing some hole previews, do some other things.
Yep.
I've already talked to a number of our pros that are going to be out there practicing. Mm-hmm. So I may run into them, grab an interview or two with them that
sure.
we can put together and put out there. We're going to have a little bit of help and we're going to have some help with some video work. I'll say that. We're going to leave it at that for now. One of the guys I won't leave as a secret is Joe Height from Hellfish.
Yeah.
And he's going to be a
videographer extraordinaire.
Yeah, he has done some of the amazing, we've talked about him before, he's done some amazing things with, you know, namely we saw some Portland Worlds video that he had put together. It was a 10-minute video.
Yeah.
And then he had done a ton of different things for Huck Lab. He was contracted by Jay over at Huck Lab this last year to put together some great stuff for his team and others. And he just does amazing work. And I can't be more honored and proud and excited to have him joining our team for our memorial broadcast, because he knows
he's a professional and he knows the sport. Yeah. It's not like
I know, and now he's hanging out with us hacks.
I know. Fool. I don't know what he sees in us. Don't keep him out too late.
No, not me. Anyway,
he's a good, you know, we've had cameramen before and they've all been wonderful and we always appreciate the help, but getting someone of his caliber, you know, and professional skill will help step up.
Skill being the key word,
unlike us.
The skills we don't have. Yeah, so we're really excited to be working with Joe and have Joe be on the team. He's going to be working a second camera that we're going to have. So we're going to be debuting our second camera coverage, which was a huge step. Some people, you know, we hear a lot of clamor. Oh, it'd be great if you could be on another card, or if you could be getting, you know, the disc as it's coming in from another angle. And
it'd be great if you had a camera on every car
along with a drone and you know, and scorekeepers for every single hole. You know, those are all part of our growing process. And believe it or not, I will let you in on a little SmashBoxxTV exclusive secret.
What's that?
It is very expensive to go from one camera to two.
Can you hand me that thing that's sitting on top of the box?
Oh, I don't know if we want to show anybody
that.
We
can show that real quick. Just hand that to me. This right here, the little box that'll help us broadcast.
Yeah.
$4,000.
Yeah, at least. Yeah. Until I drop it.
just that right there to help push.
Yeah, some stream out
there. Just to help the stream out there, to get the stream out there. $4,000.
So it's very expensive. Of course, one camera and getting this up and running has been a learning process in the last year.
Yeah.
And now we're looking to double that, and that comes with another cameraman and extra batteries and 1,000 other little things that you may not think of. Double the work for you.
Yes.
So that you see two different things coming in on the screens.
Yeah, well, you know, cutting back and forth. So if I miss a shot, that's on me. Maybe.
Yes, absolutely.
I'll blame Terry, but it's probably my fault.
it probably will be. So anyways, it's really exciting, though, because we're going to be able to increase our coverage, and we're going to be able to bring you more. We don't have a lot of downtime, I feel like, anyway.
Sure.
But we're going to be able to make sure we're always finding action for you from all over the course and different things going on.
Yeah, right now the plan is to probably stick with one card for both shots unless we get a backup, where then we can kind of move around and migrate and find you action.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So look forward to that. And
nightly podcasts.
And then the nightly podcast. So Tuesday night we're going to have probably a relatively normal or regular podcast.
There's nothing normal about our podcast.
Might be a little bit different. And then Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday nights, hopefully right from the back of Duke's, we are going to have a review/podcast each night. So look forward to that. Please make sure that you come in. And if you're around Duke's or you're around our live broadcasting, you know, we may reach out to you. Otherwise, you can take it in. And if you're not watching it that night, the next morning, you can actually log in and you'll be able to watch all of our podcast action and whatnot. So again, the battle at Vista, 11 a.m. Mountain Time on Monday. We're going to put out some links. We're going to get this all on a schedule page and put it out there for you guys. But 11 a.m. on Monday is going to be the battle. That'll kind of kick off the week. We're going to do some practicing. You know, these players are practicing and they're having fun. But we're also going to be kind of ironing out the kinks of the two cameras and, you know, having a good time with that. So that's going to be taking place Monday. And then Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, we're going to be bringing you action. We're going to, you know, kind of nail down exactly the groups and the times.
Yep.
We'll bring you live action those 4 days. And then Tuesday night through Friday night, we'll be bringing you podcasts. So if you're not sick of us by the end of next week, then you really might be a true boxy smasher, I don't know, smash boxer.
Yeah, that's...
Because I'm guessing you might be sick of us.
Yeah. All right, we're running long. Let's wrap this up here. Let's go to some...
okay, go ahead.
Let's go to some weekly picks real quick. I'm going to go first here.
Yeah, you always do.
I'm going to pick kind of a strange thing.
Yeah.
Really strange.
Like a 50 Shades of Grey strange?
Not quite that strange. Okay. Well, no, not quite that strange.
I hope not.
I don't plan on seeing the movie.
Yeah, okay.
It's a service called Stitch Fix. Have you ever heard of it?
I have so many different ideas, but go on.
It is a service that sends you women's clothing. kind of weird.
Like, I know, I had to pretend like I didn't know.
I know. No, seeing as how it was just recently Valentine's Day and Christmas before that, this is a really cool gift that I got from my wife. Basically, what they do is, you know, you go out there, you fill out your style profile. And I got her a big gift card for Christmas. And every month or every as often as she wants, it sends her different clothing. You know, they do sizes and your style profile. You can pick. If you like it, you keep it. If not, you send it back. No charge. So what she's doing is she's getting a new set fresh of clothes. They have like professional stylists because there's no way in God's green earth I'm going to buy my wife clothing. I
buy her clothing, but you
well, you have better taste than I, you know. You're like the gay friend. I mean,
well.
So yeah, so basically they send her a box of clothing. She takes a look at it. What she got a suit jacket the other day, some necklaces, whatever. And then she boxes it up, sends what she doesn't like, and then they charge her every month. So she's got a big gift card. You know, she can just kind of play off of. So if you're still out there, you know, maybe you've screwed up Valentine's Day or. You know, look at that. It's kind of a really cool service. There's a couple of them. There's ones out there for men as well. I don't subscribe to any, but I'm sure they're just as good. But Stitch Fix. So
Stitch Fix.
Yes.
Okay. I like it.
Cool.
All right. Well, I'm going to actually somewhat stay on the same theme for my pick of the week.
Your women's clothing?
Not quite women's clothing. However, this is an amazing accessory. I like to wear it in the wintertime.
Ooh.
And it was absolutely critical to me not quitting the tournament, even, we'll say, in Michigan this weekend. And
I'm sure you wanted to at times.
I would have, because they got fresh snow on Saturday night.
Oh.
They could not have gotten all 24 tee pads cleared off because of so much snow and so many people playing and whatnot on Sunday. So I had, in fact, worn a pair of Yak Tracks.
Yak Tracks.
YAKTRAX. They are Yak Tracks, and really what they are is it's like a meshed metal thing that goes over the exterior of your boot on the bottom of your sole, on your shoe, and on my Keen shoe. There's a plug.
Nice.
Keen shoes, keenfootwear.com.
Shameless plug.
I love those guys. They help me out. But I put it over the top of my Keen boot, and it gave me absolutely perfect grip. In fact, I think judging by how many times I shanked early and left consistently.
Yeah.
I think my grip was almost too good.
Oh,
I wasn't rotating enough.
You weren't
expecting. And there was snow on literally all 24 tee pads, and I don't even blame the tournament director at all, because it was just that intense of weather out there. And so wearing these Yak Tracks, which I also wore the weekend before at a local tournament, they were awesome. I cannot imagine trying to play on Sunday.
Mini Roman likes them. He says that's one of his favorites as well.
Yeah. So Yak Tracks, if you're in California, too bad. This doesn't apply to you probably ever. That's fine.
Yeah.
But if you are in the Midwest or you're playing anywhere in a snowy condition, and of course these can be used for, you know, if you go out hiking or you're doing other wintertime activities.
Yep.
However, if you want to play disc golf and you're looking for good grip, Yak Tracks, they were $29.99.
Yep.
And they fit over my boots. My biggest challenge will be making sure that I
get the pro ones.
Yes.
Because
the other
ones
strap on top.
Well, on top of that, the other ones do as well, but the pro ones are made, they're a heavier material. Mm. I had a lighter pair that I got as a gift that they weren't meant for golf. They were really meant to just be walking, and I blew them right out. Just destroyed them within like 3 holes. So, definitely go out if you're going to do it, get the pro ones.
Yeah, and I had the pro pair. They're $28.99 or $29.99, and they were awesome. So, get those. My only challenge will be to make sure that I put them in the exact same place as either my boots and or my mittens next year, so I don't lose them, so that you can reuse them over and over. And no, they do fit any shoe. Thank you, DG Mike, for clarifying.
Yep.
As much as I'd love to say go out and get a pair of Keens, they do fit any shoe. They have different sizes based on, you know, different ranges, just like buying socks, different ranges based on different shoe sizes or foot sizes. So right. Yak Tracks.
That's a great one.
Thank you.
Next week's guest is the Memorial.
Yes.
We don't really have a single person lined up. We'll probably have Dana on site. We may have AJ on site. We might have whomever we can pull in.
They should arm wrestle.
I said that earlier, actually.
Did you say arm wrestle?
Yeah.
Specifically?
Yeah.
Oh.
Maybe it's sitting in your subconscious.
I wasn't listening to you again.
Yeah, that too. Review the tape.
I think I know which it is.
Honestly, if you're a pro and you want to get on the show, reach out to us.
Yeah.
We can probably find something. We want to try to do something fun, you know, maybe play a game or something with these guys. Mm-hmm. You know, we'll bring a trampoline in for
Simon.
See
who can buy me the most beverages.
Yeah.
That could be a fun game.
Yeah. Just a little corner. Can I have a little shot of me in the corner just all week? Just be like, ooh, I'm out there.
Yeah. Well.
So, yeah. So we'll be live at the Memorial next week. So we don't really have a guest lineup, but I'm sure it'll be a blast.
And just to clarify, we did have a lot of people reach out to us regarding sponsorship and advertising. Of course, that's still available. I am going to put together a very basic offering for people who just really kind of want a shout out for their tournament or club.
Okay.
And so we've got all these different sponsorship levels, and we're kind of working with everyone as we do it, and there's no perfect system yet. However, we do want a very affordable system so that if you have a tournament specifically, and it's coming up within the next couple months,
or a club
that you just want to mention of, we do want to find a way to make it affordable. We know tournaments usually don't have a huge budget unless you're Nate Heinold.
Nate's prices. So.
Yes, good idea. But we do want you to be able to get a quick plug out there for a tournament.
For sure.
So look for that. Or if you're interested in that, contact me directly. That's even better. And we will put together, we'll say, a new level of people that just are trying to get a quick blurb out there for their tournaments.
Yeah.
And we can kind of make mentions of those throughout the week in different capacities. So.
For sure.
All right.
All right, everyone can find us out on any of your podcasting grabbing apps. I did actually reach out to somebody who was complaining that our podcasts were too long for him.
Mm-hmm.
He was saying that he doesn't have the attention span.
Okay.
And I said, you know what? A lot of these podcast apps, they'd have played at faster speed.
Mm.
So
it sounds really fast if you're talking like this. If we were going to go ahead and talk with you, like we should just talk like this the whole time. And when they play it,
should we date ourselves like the Micro Machines guy?
Yeah, exactly. But if we talk like this real fast and then they put it on double speed, it'll go really, really fast.
It depends. Some of the podcasting apps do things like they analyze the audio and they just take out the breaks.
Mm.
So the silent spots, they squeeze.
So if we weren't talking right now, it would have just cut that out?
It would have.
Wow. Well,
but some of them actually do speed up the audio. Some of them you can do both. Anyway, if you don't enjoy watching live and you think we run too long, just speed us up.
Did you say just beat us up?
That too. If you see Terry, just beat him up, okay? Take his lunch money. But you can find us on any of this podcasting apps and subscribe to us on YouTube, like us on Facebook, all that other good stuff. It helps us out in a lot of ways. It shows your support. And that's about it. I'm done. We've ran way. This is our longest show officially.
Is it really?
Not including after shows.
Seriously?
Yes, it is.
Holy cow. Well, we had a lot of really good stuff.
We had three guests.
Yeah, we had three guests. We had a lot of exciting announcements. We had a record number of people watching live, which is so exciting.
Yeah, thanks everybody.
We are 15 weeks into it, and we've got 1,000 weeks to go. So it's we got so much more. No, we really appreciate all the support. And we hope that you guys continue to log in and check out the sweet action. And
I've known you for more than 20 years. Does that mean I need to know you for another 20?
At least.
Somebody help
me. If I keep buying your wife's clothing, I don't know if you're going to have a choice.
I think things got weird.
Not yet. All right. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. For Jonny V and Terry Miller, the Disc Golf Guy, we're excited to see you guys next week for our monster Disc Golf Media Blitz. And we know that you're going to tune in so that you can step inside the Smashbox. What do you think about that?
Should I stop the stream?
No, we can keep it going for a little while.
All right. Yeah, this is where the podcast audio will probably stop. So, anyway.
Is there an after show? Jay, we're going to leave you hanging. Let's see if he comes back. Jay, are you there?
Is Jay going to hang out the whole time?
There. You have to drink it. Enjoy the show. Wow. Wow, longest ever.
Let's watch the numbers go down. 197.
They're plummeting. Well, I'm going to take a sip of beverage here. You're not drinking any.
No, I would
scissor up tonight. Or purple drank.
My purple drank. No, I'm not drinking any of the purple drank tonight. No, we were in such a hurry to get things up and going with the computer having issues. I didn't get a chance. I barely had a chance. You yelled at me when I went to the bathroom.
I did, because we got started a few minutes, like literally like a minute late.
Yeah.
And I don't like to be late for these people.
I know.
They want some of this sweet, sweet action. Anyone out there on the board before we cut to our live studio audience with some stuff? Anybody out on the board got anything for us here tonight? Gary, I got Simon, Sexton, Kale, and McCray, by the way. Yes, Simon, Sexton, Kale, and McCray. Like we said, that might be one of the nicest cards of all time.
We were joking around about how we want to get him to try to talk smack, and I don't think it's going to be able to happen. I think just, you know, like, oh, you throw too far.
Oh.
It'd be a lot of nicing of the discs. Yeah. Good call.
Or a lot of hugging, maybe.
That's just you and hugging. You really need to let go of it.
No, I don't like to.
I know you hold on too long.
I know.
You're awkward.
Keith, hope you're doing well. Thanks for joining us. We know you're in checking things out. SETI 111 and Brad, all of our DG Weekly. Wow, lots of our regulars. All right, anything from the studio audience?
That had to be not so exciting.
Yeah, it's really nobody tried to oversell you guys at all.
Yeah,
on how exciting. So again, we have Colin, and Dustin who joined us tonight. And unfortunately,
they're our first guests in the Smashbox studio.
They are, and what we neglected to make note of is that when we have the guests call in on Skype, there's actually no way for them to hear what's going on, so they only got a one-sided conversation.
Yep. We'll work on that. We'll see if we can find like a splitter for some small speakers over there, so at least they can hear.
Yeah. So unfortunately, they only got to hear half of what was going on most of the time.
Which is probably half more than they wanted to hear.
Yeah. Cheerleaders. Oh yes, Nick Lelm. We will be talking more.
Yes. Good idea, Liz Dory. It's a compliment off. We'll have them all try to compliment. Who's got the best compliments?
All right, so we're going to take our first question live in studio here from Colin Huff, ladies and gentlemen, the runner-up at the 2015 Snowblown Open, as he sits next to his nemesis. Colin, what's your question on the board tonight?
I'm
drawing
a blank.
Got me
on the spot.
All right, so Colin, this will be his second year at the Memorial.
Yep.
Yes.
He managed to take in a little of the action last year. He was a caddy and a spectator.
For my nemesis, yes.
Yes, for, in fact, his nemesis last year. Which course are you most looking forward to, knowing you're going to play one round at Vista, Fiesta, and Fountain? Which course are you most looking forward to?
Vista.
Why? Why Vista? You can play better there. Did you have a rough time last year?
No.
Okay. Good.
Okay. He feels like you. What has changed in your game from last year to this year?
Accuracy.
Okay. Well, do you remember what you shot score-wise?
Probably don't want to remember.
Probably doesn't want to remember. we could look that up.
Yeah, we could easily. I'm not going to.
Oh, I was going to say we should get on that.
No.
One of, and it's been talked about before, one of the hottest rounds at all of Vista last year, none other than our beloved
Scotty Bertard.
Scotty Too Hottie.
He'll be there this year. It's kind of funny, like, he's got a small pro following. Like, a lot of the top pros know who he is. He's like one of those, he's really good, and he just never travels when he can dominate around here. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there's a guy like that in a lot of areas, but Scotty's special.
Yeah, he is. Sporting his jeans.
Yeah, he'll be out there in his favorite pair of jeans. It'll be 150 degrees, and he'll probably wear jeans.
He'll probably wear jeans. I believe he finished 16th last year at this National Tour event, and he really had, I think, one or two really bad opening rounds of the four, so that proves how solid his final two rounds were. Dustin Skorpinski has won the Snowblown Open 2015, talked about earlier in the year. Dustin, you have been out to the Memorial now. How many times?
This will be your third, right?
This will be three.
He's going for the trifecta, third year. What was your best finish?
Last year, I finished. Remember where I finished?
He asked his nemesis slash caddy where he finished. Well, Dustin typically does play in the intermediate division. Both these gentlemen do. And as some, many of you know, at the Memorial, they do not offer an intermediate division. So they offer an advanced division.
Stepping up to the advanced division.
So that's where he will be playing this year. Dustin, I'll ask you the same question, though. What about your game do you feel has improved the most since your visit a year ago?
Maybe a little more distance on the drives.
A little bit you can throw accurate. It a little further into the water.
A little bit farther into the water.
Okay, okay.
A little more accurate.
Okay.
All yeah. right. So a little more and course that you're most looking forward to?
Fiesta.
Fiesta, simply because of what you've seen or heard, or just because it's a new one?
Well, when I traveled back there after the Memorial last year, I got to play that piece of property.
Cheater! Mm. Getting a head start.
Well, it's going to be a different layout, being an 18-hole layout now. And it was a beautiful piece of property. I'm just really looking forward to seeing what they're doing with the 18-hole layout, and looking forward to playing that setup.
All right, so if you couldn't hear, he had said that he's looking forward to playing Fiesta. He had played it a few months ago when he was visiting the area. However, it's probably a slightly different
layout
than what he saw.
Probably a little longer. So we got some questions on the board. I'm going to scroll through these pretty quick. Let's see if we can do like a fast questions. So merchandise. Luke H., that's what merchandise. We have Smashbox Dry Fits shirts.
Yes.
Reach out to Terry about them. Mm-hmm. We can get you. We can get via any social media or call him. 803-3307
mm-hmm.
and 414-803-3307. If you want one, we can get you one. We'll have. Are you going to bring some along too?
I'll have a few of those brought along, but then also
usually for.
And then also Miles Parkhill over at Paragon is. We're working with him to have some more Smashbox related T-shirts and other things out at the Memorial. So look for that.
And he's,
if you're going to be at.
Also asking about podcast sponsors. We have one. In Miles for sure.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't really pushed it yet. We've talked about it, but we haven't gotten any. We've been really concerned about the Memorial at this point. We want to get that hammered down, and then once the Memorial is past us, then we'll kind of take that next step as far as sponsors for little quick sponsors for the Smashbox podcast. Some about Whitewater taking
second at the Hoosier bowling tournament. I did see. The crazy ending to that. I don't know what's wrong with me, but I'm watching women's bowling highlights. I think I watched.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, that's cute.
Not the weirdest thing you've probably watched.
No, it's definitely not.
Terry, do you have a format or what the guys are playing for the battle? Format is singles. It's going to be most fun wins.
Actually, Dan Harbeck, thank you so much for chiming in and then effectively just becoming a battle sponsor. It sounds like your garage door installation consortium or huge conglomerate. Thank you. You just became a sponsor. That's all you had to do was ask about it. And you just became a sponsor. So whatever you're putting up, I know that will go into the pool for these players to play. Four on Monday, so we appreciate it. Thank you, Dan. We'll arrange payments later.
Bowling Green, I don't think we're making it to Bowling Green this year.
No, I don't think it's been 1,000 times.
I think he's asking for the 1,000.
I know, time. I don't remember being asked the previous.
I think we've been asked once or twice, not 1,000. But
I don't remember the previous 990.
Yeah, Smashbox is not going, and I don't believe the disc golf guy is going.
I don't believe so at this point.
Anything could change last minute. Who knows? But
money talks.
Terry doesn't like to walk.
Yeah, so I'm not taking the Greyhound there this year. All right.
Yeah, that's right. Shady.
Yeah, I Greyhounded it. If that's a term, I Greyhounded it from Milwaukee to Bowling Green, Kentucky last year, all because that was the most efficient and effective way to travel down there without driving my own car and to present Smashbox to you guys. So,
Michael Davies saying good job. Simon held his own. LOL. Yeah, honestly, I think this was a quick after show thought. I think this was one of the more aggressive conversations we've had.
Simon's a pretty
he's a
open and fun
and
guy,
and he's not, it wasn't aggressive towards him, it was more just putting him on the spot. So I liked
it. Step inside the Smashbox.
Yeah, I know, we're intimidating people now. We're not gonna get any more guests.
All right.
Pro Worlds. DG Weekly about Dustin not being near the mic. We were just kind of talking. John, what's the highlight of your pro career? Probably my one pro win down in Illinois against I beat Terry and like six other guys.
I think it was four others.
No, I think it was a field of seven or so. Memorial? So I did take fifth at the Memorial in AM advanced. I had a great week, and I, you know, I felt it could have been even better, but that was a good one. There's a little, that little basket there. So it's, but I think the pro win even more so than fifth at the Memorial, in advanced. I want to make sure to say that a lot.
In advanced.
No one's surprised. Anyone else just lose sound? Sorry, Rad. That was probably one-sided talking. Smashbox jeans, maybe. Scotty taller than you, Jonny. No, nobody's taller than me.
Nope.
Lost the video. Video down. I hope not. It's back. Good. What event are you covering after the Memorial? Don't know.
Really good indication would be, in some way, shape, or form, I will be at the Nick Hyde Memorial A-Tier April 11th and 12th.
Okay.
I will almost for sure be there in some capacity. It may or may not be live with Smashbox, but if it's not Smashbox live, it will be Disc Golf Guy video blog recorded. And I am working with the Ledgestone Insurance event the weekend before.
Sorry, I missed this one. Nick Lelm, we will have something to announce regarding Mad City Open in some aspect, whether it's tape delay or whether it's live or a combination. We're still working out the details. There's a lot of people involved in that decision right now, so it's like disc golf politics stuff that we love to talk about.
Oh gosh. Well, anyway, April 4th, I was trying to say April 4th, as I scratch my nose, we will be in I'm working to be in very southern Illinois, possibly traveling with these two guys, Colin and Dustin, possibly, to cover a Ledgestone Insurance event down on April 4th. So that could be the next one. But then, like I said, 11th and 12th, sure going to be in Texas.
Let me just say this. You know, Liz Dorries has been watching for quite a few weeks now. The minute I mentioned Stitch Fix, I get a friend request from Liz Dorries. She knows what's up.
Yeah.
I give her fashion tips. No, I don't. It's awful. You do not want that. You want Stitch Fix to help you out with that, for sure.
All right. Did I miss some?
I don't think you did. I think I scrolled through them. The video was stuck, and you had some sort of, like, probably stuck face, and I'm sure it was
duck
me.
Duck face.
Me looking off stuck as I'm face. Always looking at something computer-wise. Don't worry. That's just my wife coming in.
Hashtag Maury Smashbox. Simon didn't step in the Smashbox. He was pushed in.
A little bit. He kind of was. I mean, last minute, we had to push him in, and then we did question him about some foot faults and awkward situations.
Took it to him.
We did. As Colbert used to say, we nailed him.
Yeah, this is hard-hitting journalism, disc golf journalism.
Yeah, Luke, originally when we, about the five questions, or the question rapid-fire questions, when we were sketching out the show months ago, that was one of the suggestions, was kind of like a five rapid question, non-disc golf related thing, and we just never did it. Maybe that's a separate segment we could have, a taped segment or something. But usually when we get into a conversation, as you know, I'm usually focused on some other things, and Terry does a majority of the talking for the interviews. But I felt this week it was even more so than anything. I felt it was more quiet. So
can Simon flip a disc up? I think it'd be an upside down. Simon,
I don't know if he means like throw a grenade.
I'm guessing he can. If it's frisbee related, he can make it happen.
Yeah, it doesn't
hold a disc upside down, throw it. It is very stable. Yes. Throw like a grenade.
Oh, so basically like maybe try to throw an upside down, not grenade, like a more of an Anheuser kind like of like a U,
not a UD well, thumber.
No. What was that that we remember that? Not the chicken wing. Remember when we were throwing, we were just trying to do it at Valley View a couple weeks ago, the upside down. Anyway.
I don't remember. I don't know what you're talking about. Down spike
hiding. Kind of, yeah.
Rapid fire. Liz, my dirty. Let's just clarify. These are your words, Liz, not mine.
My dirty
30 B-Day weekend. When is that?
We can do that live. Smashbox can be there if that's what you're asking, I think.
You round up the gals and the guys, and we there's other things Smashbox can cover.
That is, that's a shoot I'm going to request to be on site for. I will not be behind the computer for that one.
So we'll have to figure that one out. Brad, thank you for supporting and joining us. Would be nice to see some coverage, Matthew says, of the Southern Pro this May 23rd and 24th. It's probably a bit, it's not that it's too far south, so to speak, Matthew. First of all, somebody would have to reach out to us as besides just now. But secondly, that is going to be the St. Jude weekend, which is in fact Memorial Day weekend and the St. Jude event on the West Coast, and I will more than likely have a hopefully a large involvement on the media end out on the West Coast with that. So this year that will not work. Memorial Day is a really tough weekend. Normally I'm playing in an event, but this year the St. Jude event is going on and I'm playing the next weekend.
Liz says, I think Liz is getting the point that the Nick Hyde is going to be her 30, her dirty 30.
Oh, Liz. Okay.
Cool.
Good.
That'll
good.
Be,
good.
That'll be a
we'll
fun
just
time.
Say good. It will be fun. We're looking forward to that. Simon, you are the father of the foot fault. Mad City sponsorship. Yep, we're working on that. Everybody's working on that.
Captain. Okay. Oh, Brad Aaron's captain. Do a barrel roll, Captain Falcon. Isn't Star? No, do a barrel. Make it do a barrel roll, Captain Falcon. No, Captain Falcon. I don't get that. I would think it's Star Fox. Different.
Definitely.
Yeah. Anyway, whatever do a barrel said. Roll.
What else do we have? Wow, we got a lot of people sitting here taking in the action.
Yeah.
Going on 2 hours. I'm just excited for next week. We got to kind of break down the studio tonight.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, a little bit. I mean, you're going to have to come back and visit at some point because we got a couple other things.
To.
I know. Too bad. So, I don't care. So, I got a couple things I need to get ready and prepared. And then, but yeah, we'll probably have the, I guess maybe have the background. I don't think you necessarily need it, but
I think we do. I think it'll look cool.
Okay. Those two guys can hold it up. Thanks for being here, boys.
Standing there holding up our background. All right.
Smashbox should interview Philo. Philo's kind of been off the scene for a little bit as far as like just over the winter. I haven't seen him do much. So I think once we've got a long list of people we're going to interview. We do one a week for 52 weeks. We're not running out of pros before we start, at least within a year.
Rad, we do appreciate it. Do we have a coverage schedule? Not officially. I don't know if you're talking just for this year or if you're talking specifically for the Memorial. We'll say Disc Golf Planet had spoken in previous conversations about how they had typically covered the women on Wednesday and Friday, and then covered men on Thursday and Saturday. Mm-hmm. And we're not certain. Uncertain as to exactly how it's going to unfold.
We want to be a little bit loose as far as if there's a really good race
as
going
far
on.
As
far as if there's a really good race going on,
okay.
We may cover an event. I mean, you can guarantee that on Saturday we will have at least the end of the women coverage and for sure the men coverage. And then we will for sure cover the women at least one round, maybe more. And we know we will not be covering the advance card, boys, unless one of you guys are winning.
If one of you guys are winning.
If one of you guys are winning, you let us know. We'll get over there.
Might be a good race.
It might be.
The list of events we're covering. No, we really don't. Reach out to us. We've got a wish list of events we want to cover.
Yeah, some events that we'll throw out there that we think are at least in the hopper in some capacity. Again, this may be live or this might be just me, but I know one of the events, obviously, the Ledgestone in the entire week leading into it. So that's in August. We have had discussions with the Amateur World Championships.
Yep.
And then into that.
Yep. We had a lot of fun doing that last year for Amateur World.
Steve Dodge has talked to us. I know the Vibram Birdie Bash Championships is going to be culminating, or there's going to be a huge event on the weekend that AmWorld starts, and that will be also in Michigan. So we're going to be covering that live for sure. We're covering the Maple Hill Open, the national tour event. We're going to be covering that live for the week at the end of June. And like I said, the Ledgestone, the Nick Hyde. We are talking with the Mad City Open, which is a week or so after Worlds, the Pro Worlds. So we're going to be covering that. Those are some of the ones that we know for sure that we're going to be at. So
there's my beautiful wife not wearing any Stitch Fix stuff right now.
She didn't like what you got
that
her.
That was my pick of the night. That was my pick of the week. So, I know.
Yeah.
She likes it. So,
all right. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to put them inside the Smashbox. Dustin is going to sit where I'm sitting, and Johnny V is going to ask him a question. And then we're going to trade off, and I'm going to ask Colin a question. So, Dustin, have a seat.
Wow.
There you go.
Put on the headphones so you can hear.
Well, it's about time.
I'm going to leave before it's my turn.
Yeah, we'll get my wife in here. All right. Dustin Skorpinski, everybody, PDGA And I have no clue what your PDG number is. So
55030.
55030. All right. So 55 thousandths. So off the top of your head, what is your favorite course in Wisconsin?
Rolling Ridge.
Rolling Ridge. Excellent. Off the top of your head, can you remember a specific shot in the past year or two that you are extremely proud of? One shot.
Not an ace.
I don't care if it's an ace.
Okay.
Don't. I'm asking the questions. You shut up over there.
Yeah, you know, there was a shot I had. It was during Am Worlds. And I walked up to this hole, and I thought to myself, you know, there's no way I can pull this off. There's no way I can get this to the basket. And I threw and went up on an Anheuser, started coming back, and it parked underneath the basket. And I just completely surprised myself with it. And okay. It's been stuck in my head ever since.
Good, good. Do you have a favorite pro that you follow or that you enjoy the most, other than Terry, of course?
I love to follow Macbeth, as do most other amateurs.
Okay.
I guess he's my biggest pro that I follow.
There's no fault in that, that's for sure. It's kind of a popular answer, but you know. What else?
Questions from the board for him?
Yeah, any questions? Yeah, good question. Any questions from the board for Dustin? You guys have no clue who he is. And just a little bit about yourself real quick. You're a movie buff. You go see more movies, I think, than anybody I've ever met. Every week I see you seeing at least one or two movies. What have you seen in the past year that has been your favorite?
I really liked American Sniper. That's one of the most recent that I saw.
Okay.
Other ones that stood out for me. It's hard to think because I see so many.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, you quite literally do. How many movies have you seen in the past year in the theater?
In the theater. I don't know.
50?
Yeah, around 50 or if not more.
But one a week, maybe more?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's dedication. That's not having a family. That's I mean, that's true.
Yeah, that'll stop eventually.
Yeah, of course. So... what is the most obscure? I think he means. You're not really a discophile, so to speak. But what do you throw mostly? What's your go-to disc?
A Wraith.
Wraith. Okay.
Champion Wraith.
All right.
It's one of my favorite discs.
Well, Brett Aaron says Boyhood. Have you seen Boyhood yet?
Yeah.
You like it?
I just rented that from Redbox a couple nights ago.
All right.
And cool. There was, you know...
Dustin kind of looks like Macbeth. No, he doesn't.
Fun fact about Boyhood. I was watching it with my girlfriend.
And, sorry, ladies. Taken.
Liz, back off.
Back off, Liz.
And there was a scene, and I was just watching it, and the scene had passed, and I looked at my girlfriend, and I was like, was there a disc golf basket in the background? And I had to rewind it and go back, and there was definitely a disc golf
really
in one of the background.
I have not heard that about Boyhood.
Background of one of the scenes.
Usually, whenever that disc golf is in a any sort of motion picture, it's like there's 30,000 screenshots of it. So I haven't heard that. There's one in Boyhood.
Yeah.
Okay, that's pretty cool. Let's see here. We're talking about doing disc golf guy bingo next week for you. So, yeah. Count how many times he signs off with people before he actually signs off. All right. And what's your best, this last question, then we'll switch it up. What's your best new disc you've added to your bag that you've liked? Obviously, your Wraith is your go-to, but is there anything that you've picked up recently that you're just like, well, I think this could really go in my bag?
Not really. I've had, what's in my bag now, it's been in there for a while.
Okay.
I do try to throw the new plastic, but nothing's gone in my bag.
Okay.
That I've tried recently. I just picked up a Thunderbird. I have yet to throw it, so we'll see how that goes.
Sure.
Other than that, I've stuck to the same stuff for a while now.
And you're not a collector of any sort, are you?
I got a few on the wall at home.
Yeah.
But other than that, I'm not.
That over there.
Yeah, basically just.
And like everything behind here that you can't see.
Yeah. I'm not a huge collector.
All right, switch.
Switch.
Unless you want to just interview Bill.
No.
Okay.
No, that was the goal. You, you do quick switch. You sit where I sit. Let Colin get in.
Everybody, I'm sure, loves like this.
Thanks, everybody. You can try out my mic now.
I know,
like
I know.
You never get to sit over there.
It's too tall.
You can pull it down. It's on. It's on the. It's
oh,
on
that's how that works. Oh, wait, we're losing.
It just screens.
Okay, okay. Like well, this feels weird, Jonny.
I like
this
it.
This microphone
it's too tall,
is so
eh?
Nice. Yeah, there we go. Make sure you talk right in there, buddy.
Not
ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, right there.
Side okay. Address mic.
Oh, sorry. Ladies and gentlemen, joining us here on the show tonight is Colin Huff. Colin, how are we doing tonight, buddy?
Pretty good. Pretty good. How you doing, Terry?
Hey, we're here 2 hours and 15 minutes into podcasting.
We're talking to Colin Huff.
I mean, living really, the dream, aren't you?
Yeah, yeah, I mean, crush hat for a second. I had you confused with Macbeth.
No,
not so much.
Not so much.
All right. So, Colin, also like Dustin, obviously here, local to the Milwaukee area. And you've been playing disc golf for how long?
This will be my third year.
So really new. Dustin's been playing, I believe, just a little longer than that.
About five.
Yeah, so you've only been playing 3 years and traveled down to the 2013 Worlds, watched a little action there, Pro Worlds.
Yeah, I think that's what got me the most hooked, actually, is seeing the pros, seeing how interactive they were with the fans. And I just really liked playing it.
Yeah, one thing courses. That you definitely are is a sports fanatic. I'd say you're as into sports as Dustin is into movies. And, you know, I know you watch baseball, you know football. One thing that's really unique about disc golf, like you just said, is you have direct access, for the most part, to our professionals. Is there anyone that you've kind of either connected with or that you enjoy, you know, that you would say, oh, if they're within 100 miles of here, I want to make sure I go watch them play? Anyone?
No, I don't think I got specifics. I try not to get too much tunnel vision with it.
Okay.
But, I mean, I like watching them all. One of my favorite ones to watch is probably Nate Doss.
Okay.
Just 'cause he's not, you know, the furthest guy or the best putter, but he does everything so well that and he just finds a way to keep in it and pull out and win.
Yeah, obviously 3 world championships and gets it done. What would you say is your go-to disc that you like to throw when you're out playing?
I have one.
Rock.
Yeah, Ontario Rock. But I just one, because every time I try to get a hold of another one, this one guy just comes out from underneath me.
All right, all right. So we'll make another plug just for Colin here. If you have any old school Ontario Rocks from the mid '90s, just sell them to me so that I can flaunt them in front of Colin. I'm a collector and a thrower, but a collector of those as well. So if you have any, reach out to me. Don't let this guy get it. But in all, here's some
taking down the studio.
Here's some discs for you guys to see.
I thought I had an Ontario. Oh no, never mind. I've got a Rancho. All
so right, just to give you guys a little history, and here I'm gonna grab this microphone here with the arm and everything. Oh, it's so fancy. So here we're looking at a few discs on Jonny V's wall. And everything from this is his PDGA disc, which is a Ontario Rock, I bet.
Yeah, it might be.
And it's actually a Rancho Rock, 145, so right in his weight range.
That's perfect. He used to be 145 in seventh grade.
And he's got some other unique ones. Speaking of Scott Stokely, here's a old X-Clone.
First ace.
Was Jonny V's first ace.
Actually, speaking of Scott Stokely.
We got a 99 pumpkin disc. Here's a Scott Stokely signed Mr. X or MRX. For those of you who don't know that is a Discraft mid-range that was very overstable. Limited first run with Scott Stokely's signature on it. And he has written on here 211.32 meters. So that was the world record he had set at the time. 211.32 meters, limited run, CE, Kansas City Wide Open,
AVR.
I'm guessing that's a Stratus, the double series.
No, this is a, this might
XL,
be an XL.
Maybe?
Extra. It's an extra. That was, I got that from Stokely.
Yep, when Stokely was running his doubles series events. So that was pretty cool. Jonny, everybody wants to see it. I'm surprised your opening shot every night isn't your face, just this covering your face like this. Jonny V's Dark Side of the Disc, October 27, 2007, Kirkland, Illinois, first place open. Again, monster field that he just crushed us, all seven of us. So yeah, some good history on the wall. How many discs would you say you've amassed? How many have you gotten over the last 3 years of playing this golf?
I counted recently. It was about 140.
140 discs?
Yeah.
And you keep how many in your bag when you're throwing, roughly?
Around 22.
22. Okay. So you've got a few extras, a few backups, and then anything collectible?
Some. I got some that are signed by Paul. 2013 Worlds, I got one of those women's Rock 3s, Glow Rock 3s. I got it signed by some of the top pro women.
Okay. And again, I know you take in a lot of action wherever you can in terms of watching these golfers. On the pro women side of things, any pro woman specifically that you find yourself either cheering for or taking note of when you're looking at the scores?
Paige and Katrina, they always seem to have good battles. But just watching them in person, it's unreal how far they throw for how small they are.
Yes.
It's could definitely learn a thing or two.
Yeah, they talk about picture perfect form, and if anyone says, "Oh, I'm not built for it, or I don't have the body type, or whatever," it might be for throwing far. And you're talking about two women who, you know, arguably weigh 100 pounds. We'll say, and
let's not get in the weight with women.
So. Yeah, I know. That's why I say we'll just call it 100. And you know, the fact that they can both, you know, push 450. 425, 450, 500 on any given day or whatever is truly amazing. We got a couple other things coming in on the board. People talking about, yes, Brad, that was all these discs are way pre-drone era. a little wing and a rock lobster for you. Very interested there, Mr. Risley. I will take both of those Ontarios. Thank you, if that's what you're talking. Do not reach out to Colin on Facebook. We got a Proto Raven on here, another Discraft Elite Z. That is a Berkeley aquatic San Marino rock, courtesy of Mike Cousins' design and whatnot. Ken Climo with a Larry Leonard autograph. When Barry Schultz won the 2003 Worlds, he had signed this. He won back-to-back 03 and 04, so we had him sign that, being a local to us and growing up with him. I'm guessing this is a TL, but that's actually a Super Rock.
Yeah.
By Jonny V here. Wow. Jonny, any one of these particularly stand out for you that you need to mention or talk about?
There's the two of them. There's that AVR, mm-hmm. which has a crack in it.
Yep.
And who put that crack in it?
Oh, God.
Might have been this guy. Sheboygan.
No, it wasn't Sheboygan.
No?
It was a week after Sheboygan.
Oh.
When I put it in Sheboygan, I put a crack in your Whippet.
Yeah, jerk.
About
dating us, ladies and gentlemen. We're talking about the Whippet driver by Innova.
Really, the no fooling X clone, the first ace disc, hole 9 at Dretzka.
Yep, hole number 9, Dretzka Park in the Milwaukee area.
And then this one, the Stratus, I don't think it might be a first run.
No, because they had a bar stamp like that kind of looking stamp. Logo.
That was from one of our very first trips down to
Mobile, Alabama
in the South. For spring break.
So some of the notables on here. Now, this dating back to like 98, 99, 98 time frame. So this was very cool. We had visited down there. Most spring breakers, you know, go out and get drunk and crazy and go to, you know, Mexico. Jonny V and I, along with a few others during spring break, we instead traveled all around the country and played every disc golf course we could, which weren't nearly as many at the time.
Did we put in like 17 or was it 27?
And it was a big deal because when we would go at that time and to play 17 courses in a week, spanning, you know, 10 or 12 states was kind of a big deal because that meant you were playing as many as you could. Now we live within 17 courses within a half hour of us. So it's certainly, yeah, we literally had to use a book. But some of the cool signatures on here, we had Wally Free, Rivers Sherrod is on here, PDGA 6206. And that's where we met the whole Sherrod family, who lived across the street from Municipal Park, and Joe and Kathy, who I believe still live there. Brad Hammack, world champion, PDGA 5912. Jim Orem, Sky South, which, as many of you know, Maddie O's dad. Rock Searle, y'all come back, he says. Kathy Sherrod, I'm not mad at anyone. Dylan Sherrod, LaVon Wolf, PDGA 580. And Joe Sherrod, be lucky. And then right in the middle there also, PDJ 9999999, Ron Russell, the Rustler. So some very cool signatures on here. And Henry signed on the back with 10565, which is just a few digits off of mine. So very cool disc and on the wall. And I'm just going to take a stab here. Was the Tracer your first ever disc?
No, it was like my second ever disc. My first ever disc was a Typhoon.
Oh, a Typhoon.
I think it got lost.
There you go. So, reminiscing here, anything else? Question, the most prized disc in my collection. Wow, that's a great question, DG Weekly.
Ooh.
Wow.
So many to go through.
Yeah, sadly enough, I have...
Is there a difference between the most valuable and most prized?
Yeah, valuable and most prized. One of the... most prized disc would be Tom Jenkins, who we've affectionately nicknamed Daddy Jenkins, not related to the official Jenkins family. Tom Jenkins gave me a number two flyer when I had graduated college, and I thought I really hadn't had any of those, and disc golf collecting and obtaining rare discs was actually harder 15 or 20 years ago than it is today. And so he gave me one of those as a college graduation gift. So that's certainly one of my favorite, most prized discs of all time. One of my most valuable discs, at least at one time. I had a USDGC rock, was a mini white embossed stamped mini rock on white on white embossed. And there was only 14 produced. One had sold for in the neighborhood of $850. Another sold around $900. And I chose to keep mine rather than selling it on eBay. So in terms of value, that would probably be one of the most valuable. Here's a cool one that Jonny V has off the wall. In fact, signed by Steady Ed 001. This was one of his personal throwers. It was called the DGA Terminator X clone. As many of you know, Discraft produces the disc that DGA ultimately brands, and this was one of them, and with Steady Ed's signature right on there.
Yeah, I didn't have another disc to have him sign.
Yeah, no other disc to have signed.
I just pulled one out of my bag.
Again, 20 years ago, before it was normal to have hundreds and hundreds of discs, most people only had a handful of extras. So, one of Johnny's nicest ones. A couple other guys on the board. AVR Night Flyer number 8, Alan Risley says a ZD zone driven 01 rock is Nick Lelm's most prized or most valuable. So very cool. Kitty Hawk, 1983 World's Kitty Hawk in his, I think that's supposed to say bag. I won't read it. I think it says bag. Alan Risley. So heading off to the memorial, you're flying out a day after me on Sunday morning. All
7 a.m. flight.
Now you guys are staying over at the cute couple's house, as I like to call it.
The cute couple's house.
You and the lady friend, Dustin, his lady friend.
With Ryan
again, Heath. Liz, everyone else, off limits. Simmer down. Off limits over here. It's gonna be exciting. You guys, the females will be joining on the trip. Do you find it any more challenging traveling to disc golf events with females that aren't playing?
We'll find out.
The hard way, one way or another.
The hard
way. You're going to be thousands of miles from home. Any chance somebody gets left behind?
It's been threatened, but
depends who wins.
Yeah, it's It's all right. There's been threats on getting pushed into the pond at Fountain Hills.
And, ouch! That's a nasty pond. I mean, if you're nice, you could push in at Vista or maybe at Fiesta Lakes. But
yeah, yeah.
If things aren't going well, into the pond, the recycled wastewater.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. All right. Alan, to answer you, I know you said a collector's corner. We have talked with Jim Trotter, and he has a really good idea, actually, for a collector corner segment. You will probably see something like that after the memorial. So look for that, as well as, like we said, our lawyer segment that will likely get introduced to this show sometime after we get through the memorial week. So those are two different segments that we're definitely talking about adding. All right, final question. Are there any podcasts that you regularly watch or listen to outside of, we'll say, disc golf ones?
No. Not okay. at all.
Well, then no follow-up, because I was going to say, what do you like about those, and how should we incorporate them? But
do you listen to any other podcasts at all?
No.
No.
He says none.
No, so. I mean, any other disc golf ones?
Me? No.
Okay.
No other. Okay. All right. Good. So you're Smashbox fan club member number one.
Yes.
Well, thank you. We appreciate
Since
that.
Since the start.
Yes. True. Hashtag big hug. All right. All right, me and Jonny V are going to sit down and wrap this thing up here in a moment, and then we'll be calling it a night. So thanks for joining us.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks for being on the show. Until next time. Until next time, when you won't be here.
Step out of the smash box.
There you go. Step on out. Yep. And ooh, we do look forward to
these
hopefully.
These are comfy.
Aren't they?
Yeah.
Colin and Dustin hopefully having some part in helping keep us under control as things take place at the memorial and all of the crazy things we have going on there. Any final?
Look how different we are now, because this is the chair I normally sit in, and this is the. You can just tell the height difference now. How we have
I
to adjust.
I look even shorter than normal, though.
I know, because normally I sit there and I'm taller, and you sit here and you're shorter. So now we have to adjust. So now it looks like
we look really
like funny. I'm looking down on you. Hi,
we
Terry.
Look funny.
We do. All right.
Anything else on the board? Pumpkin Rock was a 99, Pumpkin Disc.
Yeah, 99.
It's a 99. That is a rock.
Yep.
In some small corners, I'm sure that could be sought after for a few bucks these days. Yeah.
I've got a 20th anniversary CEAVR over there. First run Comet over here. I guess I never noticed. I've got 3 or 4 different Stokely signed discs.
Yeah,
I think
talk about Creeper.
Yeah, weird.
All these years later, and all of a sudden we take down the curtain and there's nothing but Stokely signed discs.
Where are you at, Kristen?
I think we found his first lover here.
Yeah, I think I got most of these signed at the exact same time. I just grabbed a whole bunch of them.
Sure, psycho.
Yeah, whatever.
Better that way, Brad. Switch chairs and you're good. Yes, I know. Like we said, quite a... Johnny V's considerably taller than me.
Considerably. It's empty. You don't have to worry about spilling it.
Yeah,
I didn't get any water.
Last week.
Yeah, last week
I
did.
You spilled that all last week. All right. That is... I need a phone book. Yeah, simmer down, Dan. You can get a phone book when we get your sponsorship, right? Did you hear? Dan Harbeck is sponsoring the battle.
He's giving away a garage door.
That's fine. Anyway, thank you, Dan. We appreciate your sponsorship for the battle. We know that they're gonna love it.
Kill 4 something team stamp destroyer. Smaller stamp.
But the pre-something team. Meh.
Okay. All right.
All right. On that note, thanks everyone for joining us. Thanks for putting up with our after show, our shenanigans again.
Thank you to our live studio
audience.
Yes,
thanks to Dustin and Colin. We appreciate you coming out. If you want to be part of the Smashbox studio, reach out to us. Mm-hmm. You know, there is a waiting list.
Just like Fallon and the Tonight Show.
Yeah, yeah, you got to get tickets. tickets can be found on Terry's personal website.
Yep.
you just need to be quiet because my kids are sleeping.
Yes. Yes, there's not too much fun to be had here.
No.
We get, people sleeping and stuff.
So.
All right, of course, again,
next week we will see you guys. You're going to be here watching us on Monday, 11 a.m. Mountain Time, whatever time zone you're in, you need to figure that out. But 11 a.m. Mountain Time, we go live. Kale Aviska, Simon Lizotte, Nate Sexton, and Jonny McRae will be the foursome, the fabulous foursome, the battle at Vista. All right, for Jonny V, Terry Miller, Colin, and Dustin, we'll see you guys Monday at the battle at Vista when everyone steps inside the Smashbox.